Can start. I'm sorry that we start with more or less the 15 minutes that is normal in the academic meetings, as you know. Thank you very much to be here to explain for the people that were not here yesterday. That is the first meeting of the European movements in the south of Europe. Portugal, Spain, France, Italy, Malta, Cyprus, Greece, and Croatia. Unfortunately, we don't have for the moment a European movement in Slovenia, but one of our ideas is to see if it's possible in the future to open also a national council in Slovenia, as you know. This semester is on the presidency of the Slovenia government. Yesterday we discussed about two main questions. The first one was the question of the conference on the future of Europe. We had the interventions of the president of the European Movement in France, the president of the European Movement in Spain. They are two, both members of the Conference on the Future of Europe. One, Bertoncini, is a member on behalf of the European Movement International, and Francisco Aldegoa was designated by the Spanish government as representative of the European citizens. Only one thing that we discussed during the meeting, and I saw that there is a consensus on this idea, is that the conference that once started, the idea was to have a conference for 2 years. The conference is practically not in a mature way, if I can say so, because the working groups will start only at the end of this week. There are a lot of problems. So many people yesterday suggested that this conference should postpone at least in autumn 2022. That means after the presidential election in France, to give the possibility for the citizens to participate in a better way in the discussions and the conclusions. Second point was the question of the fiscal capacity of the European Union and the own resources. Today, the European Commission will submit to the Council and to the Parliament a proposal concerning the reform of the Stability Pact. I don't know if you saw the text of the agreement between the SPD liberals and Greens in Spain. Concerning the Stability Pact, they say that the Stability Pact is enough, has enough flexibility. So for this agreement, if this agreement will be transformed in a program of the government, there is for the moment no signal that from Germany they agree on the fact that this Stability Pact should be reformed and modified. We will see, in any case, the agreement that will be reached by the Council and the Parliament. So that was the day of yesterday. Today we decided to discuss about two main things. One is the agenda, new agenda for Mediterranean, and the second is the relationship with the West Balkans. You know that the few days ago they had a summit in Slovenia discussing about the relationship with the West Balkans. As you know, there is no agreement between the governments about the relationship that we can have with the West Balkans. There are very different positions between the governments on this point. Concerning the new agenda for Mediterranean, you know very well certainly the communication that the Commission submitted in February, and so we can open the discussion on this point. We have four speakers here in presence, one from Cipro, the colleague that is the representative of Cyprus European Movement, and we have also Isamaggi that coordinate the study generali delle donne. So if you agree, I will give the floor for 10 minutes to Michalis Angelopoulos, that is the president of the European Movement in Greece, and then I ask the colleague from Cyprus,
George. First, Pelagias.
Because we are here, okay. And then Georgios Pelagias to take the floor from Cyprus, and then I will present Gennaro Migliore, Enzo Bianco, and Iliano Kumil, and then the others. Michalis.
Good morning, and thank you very much for the initiative and for the invitation. It is a pure political debate here in Rome. And I'm very glad to represent the European Union in Greece in this forum with my colleague Antoni Papadimitriou, one of the founders of the European levels of organizations in Greece, Federalists and European Movement. What is, let's say, the main characteristic of our times? It's Can I cannot see with the light. It's for me, it's
to stop the light.
It hurts directly. Okay, wait, I will continue. Never mind. The principles of the Mediterranean and the philosophy, the theory, the history were given by, as you know, from Fernand Braudel, the big historian. The last centuries, and the main characteristic that I have to underline is contradiction between policies of the European Union as the new agenda, and contradiction with the positive one and the negative one, quotation marks, what's going on now in Europe. As you know, the 9th February, February 9, 2021, the big agenda was declared as a proposal that combines 7 billion euros for investment in the Mediterranean, that climb up to 30 billion. The pandemic COVID-19 gave the opportunity to the European partners, to the European Commission, and to the Mediterranean countries to find the bridge among them, and to re-establish this financial, political, and social instrument 26 years after the Barcelona Declaration. The agenda is bigger. The agenda covers human development, good governance, and the rule of law, based on the shared commitment for democracy. The second axis, the resilience, prosperity, and digital transition. Support resilient, inclusive, sustainable, and connect the economics and create opportunities for all, especially women and youth. As we see here, horizontally and vertically, the digital agenda is one of the main, let's say, significant points of the works that European countries do. And the Mediterranean countries wish to do. Peace and security. In an unstable world, peace and security provide support to countries to address security challenges and find solutions to ongoing conflicts. Migration and mobility jointly addresses the challenges of forced displacement and irregular migration and facilitates safe and legal pathways for migration and mobility. Green transition, climate resilience, energy and environment, taking advantages of the potential of a low carbon future, protect the region's natural resources, and generate green growth. These are, let's say, the bridges that connect in our times the European Union, the member states, and the Mediterranean. But on the other hand, if wish to be very frank
and very politically, let's say, analyzing the situation, we have to support the arguments that for several years now, the European Union has been ignoring or neglecting issues of an existential level in an extremely damaging way to the idea of effective integration and its overall development and prosperity. The Euro Army and the effective protection of its borders, a common foreign policy. A divisive dilemma is full military autonomy, independence from NATO, but its dynamic existence with an organization as a potent and self-existent protection and deterrence entity to be ignored. The serious investment, a leading role in research and development in cutting edge period, changing scientific fields such as 5G and artificial intelligence. The effective, realistic, and fair management of the refugee immigration issue. Representing for years and years the island of Samos, the external border of the European Union, I have to say here that if we don't proceed to the new agreement for asylum and migration, we will be in very big danger to destroy what the European Union says it's about. From an island that has only 30,000 inhabitants, citizens, who have they have cross-bordered our island, that it is 1 kilometer and 250 meters from Turkey, 252,000 immigrants and refugees from Turkey, from different origin, as you know, in a period of 2 years and a half. You can imagine the huge problem existing all over Greece, even now that pandemic and Erdogan's policy stopped the migration flows, but we have over 500,000 refugees in our country without any response of the member states.
No.
Okay. So, as I was ordered by Virgilio, I have to stop. And as a political organization, we have to prioritize our actions and interventions. The new challenges that we have to face oblige us to be accurate, fast, and politically sharp, focusing on the near future. I cannot really interpret how these billions of euros are addressed and support and sustain different policies. And the reality says that the European Union is absent from any kind of political decision on the high level. That means that the first step in order to enforce and to unleash this new Mediterranean agenda, indirectly, of course, it is a common European defense policy to be projected, elaborated, and defined. So in the frame of the works of the European movement, a subcommittee via Virgilia for common European defense can be established in our European movement and undertake the political responsibility to propose significant institutional steps to be taken, adopted by the European government institutions. And I fully agree with the first words that you expressed to the audience and to the members, that the two language obligation, not as only as a right, but as a method and as a philosophy of working languages has to be reestablished. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Michalis. I'm sorry to be strict, but we have a lot of speakers. And in any case, I agree on the fact that that is one of the priorities that we have to put on the agenda of the international Euro movement, because the international Euro movement, to speak between us, has a committee, as you know, on the foreign policy. And we discussed a lot of time about the fact that the Mediterranean agenda is one of the priorities, but because of the fact that the influence of the northern countries is better than the influence of the southern countries, for the moment, the Mediterranean agenda is not between the priorities of the international Euro movement. And one of the reasons of this initiative today is to put this item
in the agenda of international movement. So Rocco Cangelosi joined us, Ambassador Cangelosi. I give the floor now to the president, vice president of Cyprus European Movement, Pelagias, is not connected. So we are waiting if he is able to connect from Cyprus, and then we will give the floor to him. And so I will give the floor to Gennaro Migliore. Gennaro Migliore is a member of the Italian Parliament. I know him a lot of time. And he's now doing different things and the responsibility is the president of the Europa Mediterranean Assembly that put together members of the parliament from the two sides of the Mediterranean Sea. So, Gennaro, the floor is yours.
Sorry, one moment. We have this noise. Maybe the mobile should be closed.
Yeah, because there is a noise. If you can stop the mobile, that can give us the possibility to avoid the noise.
But really, the mobile are out of line, no?
It's better. I suggest you to see the movie Social Dilemma.
So thanks so much Virgilio for this invitation, for this kind invitation, because we are so convinced as Parliamentary Assembly of Mediterranean that this kind of meeting are really useful to exchange experiences and to have the capacity to influence political processes. My assembly is a parliamentary European Mediterranean Assembly that joined with bring together 34 parliaments from the two shores of Mediterranean and from Gulf region. We are, of course, not a EU-centric integration process. We are really thinking about the centrality of the Mediterranean. And for that reason, we think that Europe is one of the key actors of the political process that can be useful to a better future for our population. For this reason, PM was warmly welcomed the launch of EU new agenda for Mediterranean, and it's represent a timely and crucial plan of action from Brussels to engage with the Mediterranean countries to address the many and often share the new challenges we face. In a few time, in a short time, I want to show you our point of view. The key priorities are, of course, first, an economic development, but Dr. Michalis Angelopoulos said before me, that is sustainable, resilient, and inclusive, with a dedicated focus on youth, digitalization, and small and medium-sized enterprises. At PEM, we have continuously brought our parliaments together with the international financial institution, because we are also permanent observer of the General Assembly of the United Nations. And for that, we have a strong connection with WTO and the European Parliament and a lot of the offices of the United Nations. And in our parliaments, we share best legislative practices that promote trade and investment in our region, especially given that many of the countries are outside of the EU trading bloc, yet remaining Europe's closest economic partners. Moreover, we have a dedicated project that aims to connect startups for the two shores of Mediterranean with investors and access alternative capital markets in order to facilitate investment that will unlock the full potential of our region's entrepreneurs. For that, we signed a memorandum of understanding with the University of Salerno on this issue, especially for the alternative capital markets. The second is the comprehensive human development. For that, this means redoubling our commitment to human rights, good governance, empowering women political leadership, and calling for solidarity in times of crisis, such as an ongoing pandemic. Third, peace and security. For us, it's the first priority. It's a prerequisite for all the other ambition of agenda. And for that, I want to stress also that when we talk on the strategic foreign policy of Europe and of Mediterranean region, we have to take in account the role played by China, because China influence is huge. It's so huge in our region, and it's possible that the division between North and South Shore of Mediterranean make easy for China to be the focus, changing priorities, because we have to consider that the instability of the South Shore of the Mediterranean affect all Europe. And so we have to be engaged to mobilize also our level of the parliamentary diplomacy to address crisis in the Middle East, in Libya, in Syria, in Sahel, in other parts of our region. And for that, we are timely involved in such political meeting that also informally are able to connect people that, an example, two vice presidents in our organization are coming from Israel and Palestine, and they have a connection, including in most critical periods. Fourth, of course, migration and mobility, but Mr. Angelopoulos said before me, and we have to take into account the fair connection with the south of the world, in particular coming from the crisis the region that are in crisis, and from Africa. And for that, we are talking in our discussion also in the Foreign Affairs Committee in Italy, where I also played the role of President of Mediterranean, also for the Italian Parliament. And to talk on a vertical continent that brings together Europe and Africa. The fifth, but of course not the last, it's climate action. And we hope that next COP26 will be not a failure, because we are really aware about the last declaration of Boris Johnson and so on. We think that we have to propose some ambitious activity to face to address the climate change. For that, I personally suggested in the last G20 climate event in Naples and in the World Green Economy Summit in Dubai and in IPU pre-COP meeting in Italy, a proposal. I've been promoting an initiative to launch an Euro-Mediterranean and Gulf community for renewable energy. As our region are abundantly rich in these resources and cooperation on this can serve as a catalyst for a greener and more prosperous and interconnected Euromed region. But I don't have to say to this conference, and especially to Dastoli, that the main idea was the Cheka at the beginning of Europe. After the Second World War, the community of energy, an economic community, can overcome the conflict that we had for several decades. Next month, a PAM delegation will be in Brussels to contribute an important discussion on the future of the Mediterranean, organized by European Commission. In advance of this meeting, we have been holding bilateral consultation with our key partners among civil society. One of the things that has emerged from this consultation is that there is still a lack of a governmental process that would bring the two shores of the Mediterranean together in a meaningful way. The Union for the Mediterranean is Eurocentric and focuses its action on economic projects rather than political matters. The five plus five dialogue, which is a good model, remains in an open discussion platform without any real decision-making capacity. Referring to mobility, it's interesting to take in account the point of view of the South. For example, the vision of the future by Arab Youth in a report of 80 pages had such results: work, study, family, religion in public life, mobility, governance. The word Europe does not appear once. After comparing the EU report on Mediterranean and that of the Arab Youth Survey, our analysts sadly referred that the Mediterranean is the area of dialogue among deaf and dumb. For that, we want to develop, and thanks so much for the invitation, the collaboration with civil society and with your organization. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Gennaro. Thank you very much. As you know, the French presidency has announced that during this presidency, it will be in February summit, the new summit Africa. The last one was a few years ago. We hope that the summit will have a good conclusion, because the last one was not so positive, if I can say so. So for us, for European Movement, that is one of the priorities. And we are very happy that the Italian government accepted the proposal of European Movement to invite the African Union in the G20. That for us, we wrote to Mario Draghi saying that it was important to invite the African Union in the next G20. And for us, that is important. So we are now connected by via Cyprus, Georgios Pelagias, if he's connected. I give you the floor, asking Georgios to speak in the limit of 10 minutes, because we, as you know, we have a lot of speakers. And then after him, as you see in the program, we have also Isamaki. Georgios, 10 minutes from for you. Over.
Thank you very much, Virgilio, and thank you for the opportunity of participating today. I will do my efforts of trying to keep within the 10 minutes for sure. Coming from Cyprus, I'd like to steer perhaps the discussion of when we're talking about the future of Europe. Obviously, one cannot disregard the importance of the Mediterranean. The Mediterranean is indeed the founding cradle of Europe and the vision and notion of a continent that shares a common destiny. But having read the joint communication for the new agenda of the Mediterranean of February this year, I noticed that there's only one single vague reference to the Eastern Mediterranean. And I believe that this is somewhat a problem. Obviously, it's not that surprising considering that the Eastern Mediterranean, at least in modern times, tend to be treated as an oddity or perhaps a mismatched region, not European, not Asian, or not even African, plagued by sectarian violence and unstable governance and chaos. The Eastern Mediterranean, at least to the everyday European, always carried the notion of being somewhat Byzantine. But what the problem with this is also that the Eastern Mediterranean is a very crucial region for Europe and the continent and the Union. It is a region which is plagued, as I said, by sectarian violence, by demographic movements, by lack of democratic principles, and to some extent, a complete disregard to the rule of law. The European Union has a crucial role to play here. It has a crucial role to play in support of the existing member states that are already part of this region. I'm thinking obviously of Greece, Cyprus, Malta, and Italy. It has a crucial role in facilitating and stimulating what we've seen as the more positive developments in the region springing out of the recent hydrocarbon discoveries, both adjacent to the borders of the European Union, but also within the member states of the Union. And the developments that I'm referring to especially is the development since 2019 of what has been now officially established as the East Med Gas Forum. Now, what is so special about this? It is a naturally developed cooperation between foremost Egypt, Israel, Greece, and Cyprus, but which today also includes Italy, France, Palestine, and Jordan. In the truest sense, it is regional cooperation at its best, and it has the potential to grow and to include other littoral states of the Eastern Mediterranean. I'm thinking Lebanon, Turkey, and even Libya. And again, this is an area where I believe, and we in the European Movement Cyprus believe, that the European Union has a crucial role to play. Obviously, as I mentioned before, I mean, the Eastern Mediterranean is a region that continues to face a lot of security threats and problems, but it's also a union with a lot of potential. And the fact that there is a strong sense that this region is being neglected by the Union is perhaps, when we put it in the context of discussing the future of Europe, a crucial potential mistake by Brussels. I would like to finish in conclusion that if we are going to discuss the Mediterranean as a whole, we should also look at the various regions, the Western Mediterranean and the Eastern Mediterranean, how these two sides can cooperate, and how Europe, to its best fullest potential, can contribute to a prosperous region that adheres to democratic principles and stands by the principles of the rule of law. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Georgios. And I hope that next time we will see us in presence. The president of the movement in Spain suggested that our next meeting will take place in Madrid, and I hope that all our councils can meet together next time for the MED 8 or MED 9. So we have now, as you saw in the program, the intervention online. by Isa Maggi. Isa Maggi is the coordinator of the Studi Generali delle Donne. Studi Generali delle Donne played, as you know, a very important role during the G20. You know that the G20 also is divided in different parallel events. Next week we have the trade unions G20, and we had a few days ago the Women 20, and Isa Maggi played an important role during the Women 20. And so I give now the floor to Isa. The Study Generale di Donne is also a member of the International Bia Movement. 10 minutes in English to Isa, that send us a paper, and we will diffuse the paper to all the participants. Isa, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Thank you, Virgilio, for wanting to bring attention and care to the point of view of women on the agenda for the Mediterranean and the path towards the future of Europe. I sent you my paper, and so today I want to bring here a summary of our position. In this time, we are living with the Italian presidents of G20, the drama in Afghanistan for the women, the COP26 appointments, and our goal now is to mobilize the citizens, associations, and local institutions to make their request arrive for a Europe that knows how to increase its capacity for action in this phase of such profound changes. The future is in our hands, and therefore we are committed to completing the many open yards of the integral process. The Next Generation EU is our horizon, our strategy for the future, and the path to achieve it is the strategic autonomy of the Union, as our President Mattarella told us in recent days. But what have done as a women's movement? Since 2012, we have been organizing events with the offices of the European Parliament in Italy to imagine together the Europe to come. And we wrote a States General of Women, the Women's Pact for the Europe to come. And during the Marathon for Europe in last February, we reflected together on a relevant basic assumption: the historic opportunity that we have in the coming months as a country and is to implement a plan for the destination and distribution of European resources in order to building now not the society we had before COVID, but a more just, modern, and new society. And during the event, City of the Future, in July, last July, we took a step forward in reflection. The focus was the cities as a places of life and a new growth, with therefore require a female vision in the decision making processes of organizing and development from a gender perspective, as well highlighted in Agenda 2030 and in the strategic framework of the G20 of the Italian presidents, and also in the work that we have in the work of a W20 engagement group in view of the global recovery efforts in the aftermath of the COVID pandemic. And so we have written in August a new document, a position paper about the cities of women, women's company driving the revival of the economy, to bring to contribution of a specialist, and on the issue of female empowerment, in particular on the empowerment on the labor market of women. And in these last days, we have organized with the movement of Federalist Movement European, regeneration of cities through work, female enterprises with the look of women in the last October. And so we are ready to put attention of women about the agenda for Mediterranean. In particular, we have written an important project in Matera 2019 about the city of the future. The city of the future are the future are the cities of the women. And in this perspective, together, we must go towards a new Europe that is a narrative and in on innovation and the ability to renew ourselves towards a new beginning, step by step, safeguarding a local dimension, but demonstrating an international vocation. for design a new Europe, starting from a southern perspective with an eye to Matera, from where we launched the City of Women, which opens up to the south and towards the Mediterranean. A slow journey traveled focusing on culture in a great movement of energy, where each can express the best of people to build a European resilient community of children, girls, boys, women, men, young and old men, regardless of age, gender, origin, social status, and residence, to build together an interesting path of social and urban development of the cities in which value is given to local economies and to economic production chains where culture becomes the new dimension of the development. Local economies focused on the construction of platform for the development of skills, cultural heritage, environment, landscape, social innovation, responsible and cultural tourism, bringing art, music, the relations between art and science, the challenges of innovation in our country's crisis and in unusual or disused areas, to involve citizens in the care of common goods in the search for unknown itineraries, in adoption of civic behavior through experience of mapping, exploration, play, and competition. We want to involve all the Italian municipalities, the Italian and the European regions, in the project to relaunch the European ideal, in particular as regards the sector of women work, security, immigration, economic revitalization. And this is our job. We have a written manifesto where we have a manifesto. We want Europe that implements concrete and structural actions to solve the drama of female unemployment and relaunches employment by investing in the defense, in security, health, education, training, and research, and green economy. We want a social Europe that contrasts the weakness of women's work, especially young women and growing poverty, by also establishing a guaranteed basic income in all member countries. We want an innovative Europe that focused on a new education and training programs that can create new jobs, develops women's companies and leadership of the women. We want to build together a broad and suggestive path of social and urban development of the cities in which value is given to local economies and economic production chains where culture becomes a new dimension of the development. And at the end, I wanted to put our attention about the manifesto that is now in also 100 cities in Italy, that contains a concrete plan for new cities with the eyes of women. And our goal is to design, starting from our professional realities, a method towards the recovery of Italy with the leading role of women to reduce vulnerabilities, create working conditions, ensure development and the social cohesion in the urban environment. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Isa. So now I will give the floor to Enzo Bianco. I know Enzo Bianco, I think during the probably the last 50 years, more or less. But we were very young when we met for the first time. Enzo is the president of the Assembly of the ANCI, the Italian Municipalities, a member of the Committee of Regions. And we welcome with a great interest his idea of a charter of human rights for the Mediterranean. I think that apart all the other things, social, economic, and so on, we think that the question of human rights should be one of the priorities. So the floor is to Enzo Bianco.
Merci, Monsieur le Président, merci. Cher Pierre Virgilio, chers amis, je vais parler en français.
Très bien.
C'est un langage méditerranéen.
Très bien. Nous sommes contents.
Tout d'abord, je voudrais vous remercier de m'avoir invité à cet événement qui me donne l'occasion d'aborder des questions très actuelles que, en tant que président du Conseil national de l'Association des villes italiennes, nous poursuivons tant en Italie que dans les autres forums européens. La conférence sur l'avenir de l'Europe intervient à un moment d'incertitude sur le destin du processus d'intégration, parce que nous ne savons toujours pas quand la reprise économique post-pandémique reprendra effectivement. L'espoir est que cette conférence parvienne à réunir citoyennes et institutions sur un pied de l'égalité, d'égalité, qu'elle nourrisse la démocratie participative et rouvre l'agenda des réformes de l'Union européenne, donnant lieu à ce que le président Macron, qui l'a lancé, entend être une renaissance européenne. À ce sujet, je voudrais dire que le temps pour la conférence doit être le temps nécessaire pour faire un bon travail. On ne peut pas choisir d'avoir un temps par des raisons de politique antérieure pour une agenda d'un pays avec l'agenda de l'Europe. Il faut faire le travail nécessaire.
Prolongation.
Exactement, absolument. Même une année et demie, tout le temps qui est nécessaire pour faire un travail vrai. Une large consultation, donc, qui laisserait ensuite aux institutions le soin de tirer les conclusions du débat. Mais jusqu'à présent, force est de constater que l'implication souhaite n'a pas eu lieu et que malgré la création d'une plateforme en ligne visant à fournir aux Européens un outil de circulation, nous ne sommes pas parvenus. L'idée des commentaires, d'événements et des partages, la conférence et l'avenir de l'Europe qui, en découle, reste une affaire d'initié. Il existe certains problèmes fondamentaux que le mouvement européen a correctement mis en évidence. L'un des étant que le multilinguisme n'est pas encore pleinement et automatiquement assuré, d'où une grande difficulté d'interaction due au fameux fossé linguistique entre les pays. La plateforme prévoit des thèmes: changement climatique, environnement, santé, économie plus forte, valeur et droit, transformation numérique, démocratie européenne, migration, éducation. Mais on ne peut pas penser que d'une simple interaction en ligne, même si nous vivons aujourd'hui l'ère dite numérique, on puisse arriver à des conclusions qui correspondent réellement aux sentiments communs des populations européennes. Je ne peux m'empêcher de constater une certaine désorganisation au niveau des institutions européennes et nationales. Les comités et groupes de travail se multiplient, mais ne communiquent guère entre eux. pendant tant que membre du comité de région et du congrès des pouvoirs locaux et régionaux, en tant que président du Conseil national de l'ANCI, je me suis fait le porte-parole de la nécessité d'un débat plus large, impliquant les collectivités locales et régionales sur une base nationale, bien sûr, voire une par région, afin de produire une prise de position aussi proche que possible des demandes citoyennes européennes des municipalités et des régions. Et une campagne de communication, d'information, de sensibilisation, c'est nécessaire. Je crois que nous pouvons contribuer à relancer l'Europe des territoires avec des actions qui revitalisent les jumelages entre les municipalités des pays, avec l'échange d'expériences civiques pour les jeunes jusqu'à 20 années, une sorte d'Erasmus civique comprenant 6 mois de service civil dans une municipalité jumelée, avec des échanges culturels et thématiques sur les principaux problèmes liés aux droits et à la cohésion sociale. Un autre sujet peut être certainement représenté par les besoins de politiques urgentes pour la résilience des villes et le changement climatique. Nous devons apprendre à défendre les proches et notre patrimoine culturel, forestier et urbain contre les menaces d'événements extrêmes résultant du changement climatique. Sans compter que depuis plus de 25 années, l'Union européenne a montré son intérêt pour le maintien, des relations avec son voisinage méridional et sur la mer Méditerranée. J'ai été le rapporteur du comité des régions au sujet de nos avis sur la question relative au voisinage avec les pays du sud Méditerranée. Le 9 février de cette année, la Commission économique et l'autre représentant Borrell ont présenté une communication conjointe proposant de lancer une nouvelle agenda pour la Méditerranée. Et ce sujet, j'ai donné mon rapport. Nous pensons che historiquement et culturellement, la mer Méditerranée a été une force d'unification naturelle plutôt qu'une ligne de démarcation pour les peuples des différents continents. Et l'initiative de la Commission poursuit l'intérêt de la paix, de la stabilité, de la prospérité dans la région. Nous soutenons la perspective de récupération post-Covid décrite par la Commission dans la communication conjointe comme une réelle opportunité de centrer l'agenda méditerranéen sur les personnes. Nous sommes fermement convaincus que l'obtention des résultats tangibles pour la coopération est la clé d'un avenir plus prospère, équitable, durable et sûr pour la région méditerranéenne. À ce regard, nous pourrons établir une citoyenneté méditerranéenne pour tous les citoyens des pays non membres de l'Union qui sont membres du partenariat, compris comme incluant des droits et des devoirs de nature égalitaire et antidiscriminatoire. Mais en même temps, nous devons entamer un processus de proclamation d'une charte méditerranéenne des droits de l'homme, ouverte à la signature des membres du partenariat, ou alternativement, nous pouvons appliquer la charte des droits fondamentaux de l'Union européenne de manière extraterritoriale aux citoyens des pays non membres de l'Union qui soient membres du partenariat. Nous pourrons créer des laboratoires de la démocratie dans la capitale des États partenaires non membres de l'Union, en établissant des forums ad hoc pour le dialogue et l'échange entre les représentants des démocraties européennes et les représentants de la société civile. Nous demandons à l'Union européenne de faciliter la participation des citoyennes du visionnage méridional au programme européen qui prévoit des échanges dans les domaines de la recherche, de l'innovation, de la culture et de l'éducation, de mener des politiques visant à réduire le nombre des jeunes qui abbandonnent l'école dans les pays non membres de l'Union, qui font partie du partenariat méridional, en leur donnant une deuxième chance de s'instruire et de former et d'entrer sur le marché du travail. Les jeunes ont un rôle très important à jouer avec les femmes dans la nouvelle agenda, si l'on tient compte du fait que près de 50% de la population du quartier sud a moins de 25 années. C'est pourquoi nous avons besoin d'une contribution concrète à l'esprit d'entreprise des jeunes et à la création d'un écosystème local favorable aux entrepreneuriats, comme a fait l'ARLEM, l'Assemblée des régions et des villes européennes, et méditerranéen avec la création d'un prix du prix jeune entrepreneur local en Méditerranée. En ce qui concerne la migration, nous pensons que les mesures prises par l'Union européenne ne sont pas encore suffisantes. On a fait un certain nombre de petits pas en avant, mais ce n'est pas encore suffisant. Sans la mise à disposition d'instruments supplémentaires partagés au niveau européen, la charge de la gestion de l'urgence des migrants incombe principalement aux autorités locales des pays européens de première arrivée. D'autre part, il est essentiel que l'Union sensibilise l'opinion publique nationale à des questions telles que la solidarité, la tolérance et le respect de l'État de droit et du dialogue au fin d'améliorer la façon dont les questions relatives aux migrants sont perçues. L'engagement de la Commission européenne à réformer le régime d'asile européen commun est un élément du nouveau agenda pour la Méditerranée. Mais les mesures prises pour lutter contre les trafiquants d'êtres humains et créer des voies d'accès sûres à l'Union européenne pour les personnes ayant droit à un statut de protection en vertu du droit international. En particulier, les victimes potentielles de la traite sont insuffisantes. Le changement climatique est largement reconnu comme un facteur déterminant dans le contexte méditerranéen. Et les institutions européennes devraient achever les Green Deal européens pour les meilleurs délais, y compris pour les plans d'initiatives visant à reconduire et à protéger la mer Méditerranée, la zone marine la plus touchée par le phénomène de réchauffement des eaux et dont le potentiel de développement économique dans le domaine environnemental est énorme. On espère que le soutien au Green Deal européen apportera des avantages particuliers à l'agriculture. En ce qui concerne l'énergie, l'utilisation de l'énergie basée sur les combustibles fossiles devrait être réduite jusqu'à l'élimination et cela devrait s'accompagner d'un soutien à la transition vers des sources d'énergie alternatives. La Commission européenne a décidé de mobiliser jusqu'à 7 milliards d'euros pour la mise en œuvre de l'agenda, en incluant les garanties du Fonds européen de développement durable et la combinaison dans le cadre de la plateforme d'investissement pour le visionnage jusqu'à 30 milliards d'euros d'investissement public. Les droits de l'homme, en tant que droit fondamental lié au respect de la dignité de la personne humaine, précède toute architecture institutionnelle et par essence la précède. La Convention européenne des droits de l'homme et la Charte des droits fondamentaux de l'Union, qui rappresentent le cadre le plus avancé dans ce domaine, constituent, depuis leur adoption, la base contraignante pour l'Union elle-même, pour tous les États membres et pour tous les niveaux du gouvernement sur lesquels doivent se fonder les principes de l'État de droit et leur application. La conférence sur l'avenir de l'Europe, de l'Union, ne peut ignorer ses demandes. Il faut donc lui donner une forte impulsion pour qu'elle produise des résultats concrets. Et nous sommes avec vous pour appuyer sur l'accélérateur. Merci.
Merci pour vous rappeler quelques points du mouvement européen. Nous avons soutenu à l'époque l'idée d'Erasmus de la Méditerranée. Vous savez qu'il y a l'Erasmus Mundus, mais nous avons soutenu cette idée. Nous sommes en train de travailler sur l'idée d'une comparaison entre les chartes, la charte des droits fondamentaux de l'Union européenne, la Convention européenne des droits de l'homme, la charte des droits de l'homme de l'Union africaine, la charte de la Ligue arabe. Il serait une bonne chose de faire une comparaison entre ces chartes, voir quels sont les points communs et quels sont les points qui nous divisent. Avec les collègues et ambassadeur Cangelosi, auquel je donnerai après la parole, quand il y a eu le printemps arabe, tu te rappelles, on avait lancé l'idée d'une communauté euro-méditerranéenne selon la méthode de la Tchèque. Quelqu'un a rappelé la communauté européenne du charbon et de l'acier. Notre idée, c'était qu'il fallait suivre un peu la méthode de la Tchèque pour créer à l'époque du printemps arabe une sorte de communauté européenne selon la même méthode. Comme nous soutenons l'idée d'une banque euro-méditerranéenne ou d'une université euro-méditerranéenne. Donc, ce sont toutes les choses sur lesquelles nous allons travailler, nous allons continuer à travailler dans cette direction. J'ai le plaisir qu'Enzo Bianca parle le français parce que nous voulons, comme je dis, relancer l'idée si nous voulons éviter la traduction simultanée, parce qu'on peut aussi dire qu'il faut parler toutes les langues. Et alors, dans ce cas, il faut une traduction simultanée. Le premier pas pour éviter une traduction simultanée qui coûte cher, comme vous le savez, c'est de choisir des langues. Une langue anglo-saxonne, qui est l'anglais, et une langue latine, qui est le français. Et ça, c'est le premier pas. Puis, évidemment, nous pouvons procéder à la direction de dire introduisons l'espagnol, l'allemand et tout ça. La commission culture du Parlement européen m'avait chargé de faire un rapport sur le problème des langues. Et moi, j'avais dit, choisissons quatre langues véhiculaires, français, anglais, espagnol et allemand, mais à une condition que chacun parle dans une langue qui n'est pas la sienne. Donc, ça veut dire que les Anglais doivent parler en français ou en allemand ou en espagnol, et comme ça de suite, en éliminant la traduction simultanée. Puisqu'il est difficile aujourd'hui d'introduire plusieurs langues sans introduire la traduction simultanée, parce que j'ai l'impression que certaines langues ne sont pas comprises par tous et par toutes, le seul moyen, c'est de travailler sur la possibilité d'une compréhension passive. Et donc, notre idée, et on va le faire, c'est de réintroduire l'idée qu'au mouvement européen, quand on doit éviter les traductions simultanées, c'est d'avoir pour l'instant deux langues véhiculaires, ou coine dialectos, ou lingua franca, qui sont le français et l'anglais. Et puis, on va poursuivre dans une perspective encore plus ambitieuse. Voilà, donc je remercie Enzo pour son intervention et aussi pouvoir parler en français. Alors, je sais qu'Enzo doit partir pour aller dans un autre engagement institutionnel. Et donc, je pourrais prier Rocco Cangelosi de prendre la place de Enzo, que je salue avec beaucoup d'amitié et on reste en contact. Ciao Enzo. Et alors, Rocco, il va prendre la place de Enzo. Voilà, Rocco, vous connaissez tous, il est ambassadeur, il est représentant permanent des Italia a Bruxelles, il est conseiller diplomatique du président de la République, il est membre avec beaucoup d'autorité du mouvement européen et italien. Avec lui, comme je dis, à l'époque du printemps arabe, on avait lancé l'idée d'une communauté euro-méditerranéenne. Et je lui donne la parole, je ne sais pas si Rock doit parler en français ou en anglais. C'est à toi de choisir. Nous pouvons passer d'une langue à l'autre, pour ça nous soutenons l'idée du multilinguisme. Tu peux parler en anglais. E voilà, Rocco, a tua la parola.
Thank you very much.
Si è possibile, dalle 4 di 10 minuti, con ça, nous pouvons éventuellement ouvrir un débat, parce che hier, malheureusement, le grand nombre d'interventions nous ont empêché d'ouvrir un débat.
Thank you very much. Much has been said about Mediterranean. I'd like to give some historical elements about the evolution in the Mediterranean. In 1995, the Barcelona Declaration launched the Euro-Mediterranean Partnership with the objective to create an area of peace, shared prosperity, human and cultural exchange. 25 years after, the Mediterranean region is facing a number of governance, socioeconomic, climate, environmental, and security challenges exacerbated by COVID. The European Council in December 2020 highlighted the need to develop a new agenda for the Southern Mediterranean. But let's take some consideration about the Arab Spring period. This period was very interesting and very important, but the Europe didn't understand what was going on, indeed. And the answer was late and was not enough. What happened in very well, it was an illusion and after a failure, because many countries that had the possibility to change, on the contrary, had a counter-revolution It happened in Egypt, it happened in Bahrain, it happened in the rest of the Mediterranean. In Libya, Syria, and in Yemen, neither Francisco nor the face of the counter-revolution parade, they descended into civil war. Tunisia was the only exception, but this exception is going to finish, because President Kais Saied, after having suspended the parliament, presidential, and the prerogative of the parliamentarian, issued a decree that grants him full presidential powers with the potential of the change of the Tunisian constitution, its transformation into a presidential republic, and maybe even the dissolution of the parliament. On 29 September, President Saied named Naila Bouden Ramadan as prime minister. She is the first female prime minister in Tunisia, and they are aware. It's really a new news, very important for the rest of the world, but it's quite, we must consider more a political cosmetics than a real change. That's the question. So what I want to say is that in Tunisia now is going towards an authoritarian regime, and that is very dangerous for the Mediterranean, because Tunisia has always been an example for stability and prosperity in the Mediterranean. So the European Union must have great care in this respect. In the past, it was not enough. The system, more money for more reform, didn't succeed. And so we must have a new comprehensive approach. Mediterranean is crucial, but now in the Mediterranean, other powers are acting. China is acting, Russia, Turkey. But Europe has not the same power and the same influence. For this reason, we have to change approach. We must have a more comprehensive approach. I remember what Foreign Minister Gian De Michelis said about the Mediterranean. He made a proposal of a conference for security and stability in the Mediterranean. It was very important, this idea, because if we have this approach, comprehensive approach, perhaps we can reach some objectives. Of course, the Union, the problem of the Union is an important one, because it focuses on five policy areas: human development, good governance, the rule of law, resilience, prosperity and digital transition, peace and security, migration and mobility, green transition, climate resilience, energy, and environment. But in my opinion, it is not enough. We must have a more comprehensive approach to this region that is crucial for our security and prosperity. Migration is, as been said, is very important. We must tackle this phenomenon in the best way, but it is not enough what is going on the EU. The conference of the European Union for the European Union is going to take into consideration different problems. I hope that the problem of the Mediterranean will be one of the most important to be taken into consideration. I think that what Virgilio was saying, the idea to start with a second method, the community of foreign steel in the Mediterranean is an important idea, but it's very difficult to work on this problem now. We must consider that the situation is worsening, and perhaps in the future we could have a new Arab Spring. It's possible because the situation is going to deteriorate in many countries, and the research for democracy perhaps will come again. But the Union didn't succeed in exporting, democracy. It's very difficult to export democracy. For that reason, we must understand much better what is going on in these countries, and we must be prepared to intervene with more and more means and instruments. I think that when we speak of a common defense, we must insert common and security defense, we must insert Mediterranean as a priority for the Union. Mediterranean is our southern border. We must defend, we must intervene, we must give all the investment to develop the other in this country prosperity and democracy. It will be very difficult because now the European Union has lost its influence. For that reason, I think that what Enzo Bianco was saying, that we must give impetus to the civil rights, to the fundamental rights, to the people to people action is very important, because we must try to realize confidence and trust with the population. They lost trust in the European Union. Now we must act with more determination in order to overcome this defeat. Thank you very much.
Thank you much. Rocco, now I will give the floor to Lilia Rockmin, so we have a little bit time eventually to open a debate. That was not the case, unfortunately, I regret it was our mistake yesterday. Lilia Rockmin is a member of the board of the European Movement in Italy. She has now a responsibility in the oil, the Bureau International du Travail, and she has a lot of responsibilities in the trade union, the CISL, concerning the question of migration rights of the women, and so on. So I will give the floor to Liliana. I know that she will speak probably or in Spanish or in Italian. I will try eventually to make a summary of his speech, my speech in English eventually. So I don't know if you decide to speak in Spanish or in Italian. If you speak in Italian, it will be, I understand in Spanish, but I can translate better from Italian to English if possible. 10 minutes.
Buenos días a todos y todas. Me hubiera gustado poder hablar en español, que es mi lengua nativa, pero como ha dicho, no es entre las idiomas oficiales. Esperemos que en 2027 eso sea posible, poder hablar de eso. Preferisco allora mi fai tu la traduzione, no?
Sì.
Ok. Quando ho pensato di poter portare una riflessione rispetto alla nuova agenda per...
Rispegni il telefonino.
Sì, sono spenti
tutte e due. Qualcuno c'è. Tu.
Aspetta, proprio.
colpa del vento.
Parlare della nuova agenda per il Mediterraneo, ovviamente noi dovremmo, e secondo me è un esercizio utile, potrebbe essere fare un bilancio dalla precedente agenda. Perché se possiamo fare anche a ritroso una valutazione rispetto a quello che ha rappresentato nel Mediterraneo questi grandi sfide, questi grandi temi.
Scusa, c'è qualcuno che ha il telefonino acceso, bisogna metterlo in funzione aerea, diciamo.
Offline.
Perché altrimenti succedono questi problemi che vi ho detto della social dilemma.
Quindi parlare appunto del Mediterraneo e del Gran Vicinato a partire da questa nuova agenda, è chiaro che dovremmo fare memoria perché non abbiamo in questo senso dato il meglio di noi, soprattutto per i grandi temi di sfida di quello che potrebbe rappresentare il Mediterraneo per l'Europa. No, a partire da uno dei temi caldi come può essere l'immigrazione, che ci ha visto protagonisti sicuramente di buonissime intenzioni, però che hanno rappresentato anche nell'ultimo decennio, ad esempio, la questione degli accordi che abbiamo potuto anche fare con i paesi dell'altra parte del Mediterraneo, che sono state sostanzialmente spesso solo per contenimento o per appunto rinforzare la sicurezza, per rinforzare, come dire, è giusto il tema di bloccare i trafficanti degli esseri umani. Credo che da questo punto di vista, vedere che tra le priorità della nuova agenda ci sia anche la gestione dell'immigrazione, beh, quella penso che sia un aspetto fondamentale, tornare a parlare, speriamo con maggiore determinazione e concretezza, sul regolamento di Dublino, che io credo che da questo punto di vista sia proprio ora di poter cercare di sciogliere i nodi rispetto ai richiedenti asilo, così come una migliore governance del fenomeno dell'immigrazione, che può essere solo e solo unicamente attraverso un allargamento dei flussi regolari degli immigrati che vengono, ecco, che scelgono di venire in Europa come un tema europeo e non più come un tema individuale dei singoli paesi.
Yes, Liliana, say that is not the first time that the European Union is elaborating an agenda for the Mediterranean. I don't make the list of the initiatives of the Commission and the European Union. Now we have this new agenda. One of the priorities of this new agenda is, of course, the question of migration. For the moment, the agenda of the European Union was to stop, if I can say so, the migration put on the agenda only the question of security. We have to modify the Dublin rules, first of all, for the question of asylum, but secondly, also to have a good governance of the economic migration, to open the way of the possibility to have more people coming in Europe, having for this an approach, considering that is a European problem and not only a national problem.
L'interscambio commerciale che avviene anche con questa realtà del Mediterraneo deve anche essere, come dire, essere integrato in un scambio maggiore anche di flussi di scambi di studenti, di aspetto anche culturale che può e deve rappresentare un vero traino, no? Quella solidarietà attiva che vuol dire anche cooperazione e aiuto allo sviluppo. Credo che nel preambolo la nuova agenda del Mediterraneo metta anche le basi, perché parla di una centralità della persona, di una centralità anche della realtà del Mediterraneo che deve e sicuramente può rappresentare la storia. I nostri antenati ci consegnano quello che era il centro del Mediterraneo in termini di scambi commerciali. Io credo che da questo punto di vista abbiamo tutte le prerogative. Certo, questo deve partire anche da un protagonismo non indifferente, no? Uno dei temi, dei grandi temi dell'agenda è la pace e la sicurezza. Pace e sicurezza che deve veicolare un impegno anche di una parte della popolazione importante che sono la componente femminile. Beh, ci sono risoluzioni delle Nazioni Unite che impegnano i singoli paesi a poter coinvolgere la popolazione femminile nella ricostruzione della pace, perché è una leva fondamentale, non solo perché veicolo di coinvolgimento della società civile, non solo perché c'è dove sono stati scontri bellici, dove sono state guerre, ovviamente la parte più debole, oltre che la società civile, sono quelli che pagano il prezzo più alto, soprattutto sono i diritti delle donne, dei bambini. Pensare a una ricostruzione sempre utile e funzionale, lo abbiamo sperimentato e ci sono appunto le soluzioni che vanno onorate in questa direzione. Così come sono convinta che in Europa farebbe bene, io mi auguro che il nostro paese avrebbe, se possa vedere la luce, una commissione indipendente che valuti le vittime della tratta, perché io credo che da questo punto di vista questo sia anche un elemento fondamentale. No, lo sfruttamento e la riduzione alla schiavitù di uomini e donne in Italia, in Europa, stride con una realtà che si approssima e vuole vedere un paese, un continente più ricco, un continente che ha imparato le lezioni dell'impatto del Covid, perché io credo che in questo senso la storia abbia dato una grande lezione, e noi, lo dice il Papa San Francesco, che in questo senso ci dà le grandi lezioni anche di indirizzo, no? Il peccato più grande che potremmo avere oggi all'indomani di quello che abbiamo potuto vedere 2 anni fa a questa parte, penso che tutti hanno ancora fresco il ricordo di quello che è significato essere chiusi, impauriti di fronte a un nemico che poteva essere rappresentato da un virus che non riuscivamo a combattere con le nostre armi, che era la ricerca, che erano i vaccini. Ma la lezione che oggi abbiamo davanti, che dovremo mettere in campo, è quel misurarci anche con un modello economico, sociale diverso, perché chi pensa che l'impatto del Covid sia stato democratico, sappiamo bene che non è così, sappiamo che non ha colpito a tutti per uguale, soprattutto nei paesi ovviamente dell'altra parte dell'Africa. Adesso noi abbiamo la fortuna di essere in Italia, di essere in Europa, dove i sistemi sanitari, il sistema di assistenza, le vaccinazioni e comunque sono un strumento reale. Ci sono paesi in cui questo tema ancora è un sogno, non è un traguardo, e in questo senso io credo che la solidarietà tra i paesi, perché nessuno si salva da solo, siamo tutti sulla stessa barca, e perché tutti siamo assolutamente vulnerabili di fronte anche a una diffusione delle altre varianti, e questo ci consegna, siamo molto interdipendenti, perché il mondo è interdipendente. Tutto quello che noi riusciremo a fare in termini anche di rispetto dell'ambiente, di politiche di sostegno rispetto all'ecosistema, se non lo facciamo si rivedrà contro. Questo vale anche per la grande battaglia che oggi abbiamo davanti.
Liliana a positive approach to the communication made by the Commission, remembering that in this communication that was also in the other speeches, the Commission put on between the priorities the role of the person, not only the role of the collective members. The question of peace and security, and mainly the question of the engagement and the role of the women, empower women, not only from an economic point of view, but also in the society. Liliana remembered that the women are the part of the population that suffered more than the others all the consequences of the situation in these countries, and also the consequences of the COVID. So that is one of the main questions that we have to raise in your attention. And also speaking about the fact that we have to have this solidarity between countries, the interdependence between countries, and the fact that the COVID create a problem of disequalities
between the countries, between the people and the regions and the classes between the countries. So the COVID has had no general consequence for all the people, but created disequalities, and we have to fight against these disequalities.
Cercherò di essere veloce perché è faticoso. Un aspetto importante, credo che noi come organizzazione sindacale abbiamo anche dovuto scendere in una grandissima manifestazione di recente per riaffermare la forza del rispetto di uno Stato di diritto, della garanzia del rispetto della democrazia, che è fondamentale, perché in queste circostanze, in questo momento così difficile, dove le difficoltà mordono la carne viva delle persone, ci sono anche forze nostrane che cavalcano questa difficoltà delle persone per cercare di spostare l'attenzione rispetto a una necessità di essere coesi, di essere uniti, proprio perché oggi più che mai noi paesi, continenti, ma anche con tutta la sfida dell'altra parte del Mediterraneo, dobbiamo essere in grado di poter avere una risposta all'unisono del rispetto della persona, rispetto anche della democrazia, perché è necessario dare un grande segnale di confronto, anche pur avendo magari anche diverse idee rispetto ovviamente un piano di un Stato di diritto, di un rispetto delle persone, rispetto delle leggi. In questo senso credo che questo fa bene sperare nell'agenda del Mediterraneo il fatto che ci sia un grandissimo impegno per rinforzare le democrazie, per rinforzare i diritti delle persone, perché dove esistono lo Stato di diritto, dove ci sono il rispetto delle norme, ovviamente si tende e si garantisce i diritti di più deboli. I più deboli, lo diceva bene l'amica Isamaggi, noi abbiamo una grande sfida e siamo riusciti, probabilmente l'allineamento planetario, dico io, ma probabilmente l'impegno del G20 presieduto dall'Italia, ma anche il movimento della società civile che si è attivato per cercare di mettere al centro i problemi reali delle persone, ha dato un protagonismo diverso e sta indirizzando in un grande impegno per un piano nazionale di ripresa e resilienza che ogni singolo paese ha messo sul campo. Io credo che l'Europa in questo senso ha dato un grande colpo, come dire, di segnale politico che finalmente c'è, ha battuto un colpo, perché l'egoismo dei singoli paesi, il concetto che negli ultimi anni avanzava rispetto alla inutilità, la crisi probabilmente ha fatto unire le forze, gli ha dato un grande segnale di non solo investimento di risorse, grande liberazione di risorse che sarà utile per poter riprendersi, ricostruire, ma soprattutto che sia un primo segnale perché dia un metodo di lavoro di solidarietà, di reale, come dire, finalmente vedere alla luce l'insieme di Stati Uniti, la confederalità dei Paesi Uniti per l'Europa. Io credo in questo senso sia un grande traguardo questo. Probabilmente la crisi, non tutti i mali vengono per nuocere, ci ha dato una mano in questo senso e credo che bene fa la nuova agenda del Mediterraneo mettere al centro anche le sfide che noi abbiamo, non soltanto sulla transizione green, sulla transizione e la digitalizzazione. Però l'aspetto importante che noi dobbiamo tenere in conto è che nessuno va lasciato indietro e questo vale per i singoli paesi, vale anche per la componente che all'interno noi abbiamo un grande problema, anche il tema delle donne e giovani nel nostro paese, e deve essere come Stato peraltro nel nostro piano di ripresa e resilienza messo al centro, perché devono darsi determinate risposte per poter creare le condizioni di una ripresa uguale per tutti, reale e che tenga anche la capacità di poter dare quelle risposte che negli anni non sono arrivate in modo giusto tutti per quale. Quindi questo è anche un tema che noi pensiamo che dall'altra parte del Mediterraneo deve tenersi in conto, perché un'immigrazione dove c'è un alto tasso di presenza femminile, dove la presenza femminile delle donne immigrate in questi anni ha risolto alcuni problemi scaricandole sulle spalle, no? Basti pensare al tema della cura e a quello che le donne immigrate hanno sopperito per la mancanza di sostegno di welfare di prossimità, di tutto quello che poteva essere in termini di servizi di cura ai bambini e agli anziani. In questo senso io credo che dobbiamo pensare a un futuro, un disegno che tenga dentro la possibilità anche di riconoscere la libera scelta di poter mettersi in gioco, di fare maggiore partecipazione delle donne nel lavoro, di tutte le donne, gli italiani, gli immigrati, giovani, meno giovani, ma che deve essere in centro verso un lavoro giusto, un buon lavoro, non un lavoro che va a scapito dell'altro o che vada appunto alla relazione dei diritti degli altri. Grazie davvero, grazie dell'ascolto.
Thank you very much to Liliana. She said that between the priorities, there is the priority of the respect of the rule of law of democracy. That is a question that concerns not only the European Union, but also our neighbor countries. That is the reason because the European Union should work in this direction. It's important that the new communication of the Commission, the High Representative, put on the agenda also the question of the priority of the rule of law beyond the of democracy. The question is to create a new social and economic model in which we have to take into account the role of the women. First of all, giving them the possibility to have a free choice to participate, not only to participate in the work world, but to participate generally in the society. That is the role that should be played by the European Union in the relationship with the, these countries and putting on the agenda, the new agenda of the Mediterranean proposed by the Commission and the High Representative, hoping I can add that the governments will accept the concrete ideas that we can find in this communication that we discuss tomorrow between us. So thank you very much to Liliana, hoping that in 2027 all the European citizens will have a passive comprehension of the other languages, giving the possibility to avoid the interpretation, of course, assuring the work also for the interpreters and the translators, because eliminate the translation is not the reason to provoke more unemployers from this point of view. So you have to pay attention also about the possibility to respect also the work of the people that is our connection with the other people in the world. So we have a little time to open eventually a debate that was not the case yesterday. So I ask the people in the room if we want to pose questions to the rapporteurs or have also the your point of view, Papadimitrou from Greece and Roderick Pace from Malta for the moment. Then, of course, you have the right to. It's better that you come here to use the microphone or you have a voice so high that you.
It's always high.
It depends of the high level of
maybe the... I need the microphone because they
have to... of course. Short and you can
good morning. Discussing about the Mediterranean, I think it's important also to speak about the situation in the Eastern Mediterranean and refer to Turkey, which is acting in the area nowadays politically and militarily in the base of its neo-Ottoman Mavi Vatan Blue Homeland Doctrine. I'm Greek and suffer this because this is an everyday happening in our region. The purpose of the so-called Blue Homeland strategy is that Turkey should dominate the Eastern Mediterranean and reclaim the mercantile and maritime power once held under the Ottoman Empire. The same applies to islands and sea territories, especially to islands in the Eastern Aegean Sea, Chios, Samos, the Greek islands, the Dodecanese, so as with respect to Cyprus.
For example, yesterday, the vice president of Turkey said that Turkey occupy, I mean, Cyprus belongs to Turkey since 1571, and the 75% of the Greek population are just invaders. This is a policy completely illegal, of course, violating basic principles of international law and the United Nations Convention in the Law of the Seas. The Blue Homeland Doctrine is a term associated with Erdogan's interventionist, expansionist foreign policy in neighborhood Cyprus, Greece, Iraq, Syria, etc. It is brought in its broadest sense, promoting greater political neo-Ottoman imperialist Turkey political ideology with regions formerly under the rule of Ottoman Empire. Greece, Blue Homeland House, for example, the justification for Turkish intervention in Libya in 2019 resulted in the signing of a non-valid bilateral maritime delimitation agreement that fixed the exclusive economic zones between Libya and the Eastern Mediterranean and Turkey. Erdogan hoping to open a corridor between Greece and the Aegean Sea and the gas fields of the Eastern Mediterranean and control the space crossed by the potential underwater gas pipeline that would be built and served by a Greek Cypriot Israeli consortium. Under this, Turkey is claiming that all sea waters, even south of Crete and eastern of Rhodes, the islands, Karpathos Islands, etc., outside of a 6 miles zone, are under Turkish sovereignty. Greece has negotiated and signed an exclusive zone agreement with Egypt and Italy, and is negotiating one with Albania. Okay. Following the above, Greece and France have just signed the landmark military defense agreement that provides mutual assistance in the event of one party coming under attack by a third country, even if the latter belongs to NATO. I want to conclude that it's about time to start discussing a common European defense policy in the European movement, and nowadays in discussing and redefining the future of Europe, I think it's important. And even I would propose to expand the Foreign Affairs Commission of the International European Movement to a Commission on Foreign Affairs, Security, Defense. So in this way, we promote and we will start our organization to start discussing this specific issue. Thank you.
Thank you, Anthony. Roderick Pace from the European Movement in Malta, the president of the European Movement in Malta. Then I don't know if other colleagues from the other. No, because you need this strange instrument.
And you can remove your mask, I think, if I can violate the German rules.
Oh, okay. Sorry about. Yes, I think when listening to all the speakers, I was very pleased with what they were saying. But I want to be to play the devil's advocate here, in a sense that isn't it time that we put our Mediterranean policy to some scrutiny, serious critical scrutiny, because clearly, although it has successes, I do not think it is negative. It is not being successful in projecting a Pax Europea sur the region and on the region. And there is a problem. I mean, what is it that countries like China and other powers like Russia, Turkey, which are extending their power outwards, and we seem to be stagnant with one of our main objectives. How can we rescue the countries, try to pull them out of the middle income trap that they seem to be trapped in? So I think our agenda is a bit too convoluted, and we must, I think, focus, think about this. I mean, I'm not even myself convinced, but this is questions for further thought. Think about focusing on high priorities, like migration is a priority, but then there is a bit longer term priority of water in the region, where we have the technological capacity and capability to help these countries. There is the question of health. It has come out very prominently during COVID-19, where again, we have the technology to help these people and do what the Chinese are doing. I don't like too much emphasis on peace and security, not because I am in favor of war or that war can change anything in the region, if not for the worse, but because I don't want to create an area of peace for Chinese investment. I mean, let's first create an area of peace for ourselves in Europe and for these people. So let's be, I mean, let's focus on the essentials. Let's focus on labor rights, ILO conventions that they are implemented, that there is a rule of law, at least in the business sector, and perhaps from there, it would be a stepping stone towards creating a wider area of rule of law on human rights. That is some thoughts about, you know, thinking outside the box. I think the new policy is a continuation of the old policies. There is nothing wrong with continuation of policies, but is this the way forward for us Europeans in the next 10 or 20 years?
Thank you, Professor Pace. I don't know if other Pace, yeah, is the English translation. Or...
So,
you prefer Pace, Professor Pace. Sorry to destroy your family name. So I don't know if there are other interventions from the room. If it's not the case, but I suggest if you want to take the floor, of course, we will be very happy, but we will dedicate the last part of our meeting to a change of view for your general point of view about the question that we discussed yesterday and today. I will give the floor about it for 2 minutes maximum to Michalis and to George as two rapporteurs for the two European movements in Greece and Cyprus to react to the debate. 2 minutes to Michalis and 2 minutes to the George.
I think, dear Vitilio, that the speakers have covered crucial aspects of the new Mediterranean agenda, raising as well the major problems that the European Union and its member states face in our times. That means that it is a political, in quotation marks, instability of what we have to prioritize, what we have to do in order to promote this kind of big political, social, and economic interventions all over the world, especially in our zone. So I think that these moments, because the European Union is existing and it's galloping for the future in a philosophical way, to present it, we have to, the European Union has a very important role to play, not only as a stakeholder, not only as the expression of the willingness of European citizens to follow this European idea, but as a practical institutional steps to be taken. So let's say standardize and give us a resolution, traditional resolution that concludes all of these that were heard, expressed, analyzed, and presented here in order to go on for the new year to come.
Thank you very much. Georg, I don't know if you are always in connection.
Yes, I can hear you. It's fine. Yes, I just wanted to come back a little bit to what Ambassador Changilosi mentioned before, as well as Professor Pace, with regard to the role of the European Union and in contrast to the Arab Spring and the new players that we're seeing in the region. The point here is that what these states shown, what China has shown, what Turkey has shown, what Iran has shown, and so on, is that you do not need democracy to have economic prosperity. And this is, I believe, is one of the biggest challenges for Europe. Now, how can we battle this? Obviously, there are various ways of addressing this. But one of the key issues is that Europe cannot be seen as inconsistent, and that it has lost its credibility with regards to its own principles. The moment that the Europe starts wavering on its own principles that it claims to uphold vis-a-vis its own member states, it shows to other states in the region that it is not a credible partner. And I think this is one of the greatest challenges that Europe is facing in the Mediterranean today.
Thank you very much. So we are now at the end of our third session. I ask the participants, the non-Italian participants, or all the participants, to sign the list of presence in the end of the room. Erasmo is there, and you can sign the list to Erasmo. And then you have now the coffee break, not the lunch. That means 10 minutes of coffee break. And then we come here back to the fourth session concerning the Western Balkans, chaired by Claudio Cappellini, with the speakers as Natasha Owens, president of European Movement in Croatia, Laura Mirakian, if she is here, and Ugo Poli online, that is General Secretary of the Central European Initiative. And then, if the people will respect the time, we will have more time to have a debate, general debate about the four priorities that we discussed together, the Conference on Future Europe, the own resources, the Mediterranean agenda, and the Western Balkans. We have here on the table the last conclusion of the summit, and I thank Natasha that sent us these conclusions. So if the people want to take the copy of the conclusions, it will be useful to discuss about it during the fourth session. Thank you very much, and have a nice and good coffee break, Italian coffee break, not the starting with the fourth session, and with if the speakers are correct with their time, we have time at the end to have an exchange of view of all the questions that we discussed yesterday and today. I say nothing, only the fact that you have is on the table, here on the table, the conclusions of the summit that took place in Slovenia a few days ago with the governments. And so I ask Claudio Cappellini, that is a member of the board of the International European Movement in charge of European Affairs of CNI. He will explain what is CNI for our non-Italian colleagues. I give the floor to Claudio, and then the other speakers that are here on the table or online, Ugo Poli. Claudio, the floor is to you.
Thank you, Virgilio. Very shortly, I am Claudio Cappellini, responsible of European Union policies for CNA. CNA is the National Confederation of Italian and Small and Medium-sized Enterprises. We have about 600,000 members and business members, and effectively we represent a large majority of our Italian productive system, and also we are belonging to the European Umbrella Federation of SMEs, a small business organization, which we mentioned this morning is a key element for developing cooperation in the Mediterranean area. The SME organization at European level is named SME United. This means that SME are stronger if they get united through European values. That's why I accepted also the invitation, because I was invited by Virginia to attend and to try to moderate this fourth session, which deepening how the EU and the Western Balkans could give a contribution to also to the future of Europe, to the new challenges that Europe is facing, starting from your experience and how we can restart together. So we have two important speakers, Natasha Owens, president of the European Movement in Croatia and a board member of the International European Movement. We have on my left, Laura Mirakian, former ambassadors and Ambassador by the it's, I only meant as a horse.
Ci sono due tipi di ambasciatori. Uno è ambasciatore perché va in un posto come ambasciatore, e l'altro va in un posto come ambasciatore, ma è ambasciatore di grado, come i generali di corpo d'armata.
And then we have Ugo Poli, which is
his project manager, not general secretary.
Project manager of the Central European Initiative, and he will intervene via video. So now I stop and I give the floor to Natasha Owens. Please, Natasha.
Thank you very much. It's thank you, Michalis.
In advance.
I would first like to thank the president, Mr. Dastoli, for organizing this event. And it's so nice to be in person again after a long time. It's so nice to see our old friends from national councils and while talking and being late for this session during the coffee break. We said we would like to have more events, not necessarily bilateral, but we can, national councils, there is a need for us to hear each other, to communicate, and thank you for bringing us from the past to the future. I was hearing yesterday and today, everyone was saying that his topic was very important for the future of Europe. I think this, our topic, is very important for the future of Europe. As you know, I'm coming from Croatia, and Croatia was the last country that entered EU since 2013, when we entered the EU. There was no enlargement. Actually, enlargement, the word of enlargement was not very popular, let's say. I'm happy now, Slovenian presidency has enlargement as a priority. So let's hope that we will have new member states very soon, and EU will not be 27, it will not go to 26 or to 25. I hope it will be more of us. Of course, all the criteria has to be met, and it's not that we need new members, that we will have problems with them, but it's, I think, down to all of us to help, especially civil society, and to work with them and try to help them to become new members. This session is on Western Balkans, so what I can definitely, and you will agree with me, say that Western Balkan countries have been working for a long time to join the EU and to implement EU mandated reforms. After a long period of stagnation in terms of EU enlargement, now is the time to act and reintroduce the entire spectrum of EU policies that affect the region to the agenda. As I mentioned before, the Slovenian presidency has made the Western Balkan enlargement a priority, with the goal of bringing the EU to the six Balkan countries by the end of the decade. Saying this, the president of European Commission, von der Leyen, she visited all six Western Balkan countries on 28 to 30th September, and she did pass the clear message to each one. She passed the clear message to first all of them, all six Western Balkan leaders, to use the Western Balkan summit to jointly demonstrate the shared strategic interest of the EU and the Western Balkans, and to play a constructive role in the preparations. Then she passed the message to Serbia and Kosovo. The message was to find constructive solutions, including framework of the dialogue. The message to North Macedonia was that North Macedonia needs to find a mutual acceptable solution to pending bilateral issues with Bulgaria. She said Commission will help where it can, but scope for intervention is limited. Regarding the Montenegro, The message was that Montenegro needs to start delivering on the EU accession related priorities, in particular in the area of rule of law. We've heard a lot about rule of law actually yesterday. We were talking about breaching the rule of law from the member states. No. So this is a problem that we are facing every day. And definitely the new member states, future member states, has to prove that they will follow the rule of law. So she said, accession remains a merit-based process. Without political dialogue and willingness to compromise, it is not possible for Montenegro to move forward in the EU accession process. Bosnia and Herzegovina needs to fulfill the 14 key priorities from the Commission opinion in order to move forward to its EU path. This summer's new political crisis risks hindering this path of reforms. The Commission has made clear that boycotts and blockage are unacceptable. The good functioning of institutions is key to advancing on EU reforms and secure the country's progress towards EU membership. Regarding Kosovo, the Commission continues to stand behind its assessment of July 2018 that Kosovo has fulfilled all visa liberalization benchmarks. It is now, she said, for EU member states in the Council to move this forward. Kosovo needs to continue to fulfill all conditions while addressing remaining concerns with the relevant EU member states. After her visit to all six countries, Western Balkan countries, there was a summit during the Slovenian presidency on the 6th of October. As Virgilio said, there is a declaration that has 29 points. And if you want here, be prepared for this. I'm not going to go through all these 29 points, but what I will try to summarize and try to stay in these 10 minutes. So EU leaders adopted a declaration at the summit, and it's unquestioning support for the Western Balkans countries that they have European perspectives. It outlines plans to promote connectivity as well as green and digital transition in the region and political and security cooperation commitments. The declaration presents a set of concrete deliverables that will help the Western Balkans, such as 30 billion euros economic and investment plan, the pledge to boost COVID-19 vaccination rates, the path towards lower roaming costs, an innovation agenda for the Western Balkans, green lanes and transport community action plans. EU leaders reaffirmed their commitment for six Western Balkan countries to join the Union, but they held off opening full negotiation with Albania and North Macedonia. As EU Commission President Ursula von der Leyen said, the Western Balkans are part of the same Europe as the European Union. The EU is not complete without them. And my commission will do its utmost to advance the accession process. The leaders recalled that the Western Balkans have been closely involved in a number of EU initiatives to battle the epidemic as a result of their close and effective partnership with the EU. EU leaders pledged to improve access to vaccines, diagnostics, and treatments for EU partners. By the end of 2021, they promised to assist all Western Balkan partners in achieving immunization rates compared to the EU average. The EU is the principal political, economic, and trade partner of the Western Balkans. The EU is currently giving financial support to the region through the Economic and Investment Plan, committing 30 billion euros over the next 7 years. Through 10 investment flagship, the EU will provide 9 billion in grant funding. The Economic and Investment Plan mission is to encourage long-term economic recovery, expedite the green and digital transition, boost regional cooperation, and foster convergence with the EU in this way. With numerous common security problems facing the EU and the Western Balkans, the leaders committed to increase their collaboration on contributing to EU security mission and operations, addressing disinformation and other hybrid threats, enhancing cybersecurity and cyber diplomacy, fighting against terrorism, radicalization, and organized crime, combating money laundering and human and drug trafficking, responding to developments in Afghanistan. It's mentioned Afghanistan during the presidency, during the security, and it follows with migration issues. Yes. So EU has indicated that it's ready to further off its help for Western Balkans allies in dealing with migration issues. Strengthening asylum systems, combating migrant smuggling and illegal migration, returns process, border management, information exchange, and reception capacity should all be prioritized. We know that the last Western Balkan summit before this one in October in Slovenia was organized and held during Croatian presidency. It was in May last year. Prior to this, the Western Balkan summit was held in Sofia in 2018. So on this recent one, the leaders decided to have summits, EU-Western Balkan summits, everyone. So they already scheduled the one for 2022. Regarding the EMI, European Movement International Position, that we are all the members of, we all know that European Movement International supports a positive enlargement narrative in the Western Balkans, and it is stated in our policy position on promoting peace, stability, and investments in the Western Balkans. For all of you present, we also provided this position. So if you want, you can take one copy. In the mentioned statement, it says that EU must maintain its persistent presence in the region and ensure that the Western Balkans may have a common European destiny. Furthermore, the Union should make it possible for the six countries to improve citizens' living standards and minimize inequalities in the region through public investment and funding in the region. Our meeting is about the Conference on the Future of Europe. So regarding the Conference on the Future of Europe, we are stating that it will involve citizens from across Europe, as well as citizens from the countries that are not yet members of the Union, but are on the path to becoming members, such as the Western Balkans. We would like active participation of Balkans representatives, including civil society organizations, and this is the need to complete the conference scope, keep citizens engaged in the process, and add in the resolution of differences. I don't know, Virgilio, if I have more time. I have the statement from North Macedonia, because I asked our sisters, Serbia, North Macedonia, Montenegro, what is their feeling, what they have to say about the enlargement and Western Balkan summit. So I did receive from North Macedonia
to the colleagues.
We can send it. Yeah. I have it. We can send the whole statement. But if you allow me, I will just read the two paragraphs, if that's okay. Thank you.
Yes.
Thank you. So it says, the European Union, as the largest economic and political partner of the Republic of North Macedonia, should abandon the general declarative approach and fulfill its promises by encouraging perceptions among the European public that the Western Balkans is the future of Europe. If the question of enlargement is really well posed in the EU, Concrete and clear roadmaps are needed for progress towards full membership. The undertaking of key economic and social reforms in the coming period relies significantly on the support provided by the EU through the Economic and Investment Plan, the Green Agenda for the Western Balkans, and other specific projects. Our task is to ensure transparency of the whole process with independent pluralistic media and a strengthened civil society. Macedonian citizens are aware of the current situation in the European Union. The Union is facing the consequences of the pandemic crisis, health, economic, social, changes after Brexit, and the need for restructuring and symbolic strengthening, as well as many other challenges imposed by global process. In this context, it is important to strengthen and emphasize the European integration process in the region, so as not to leave any room for action and influence of other global powers by involving these small countries in global geostrategies with the risk of jeopardizing the fragile stability in the region. So I think it is a call for help, for a hand. And just to finish in positive way, let's all together give them a hand and hope that the enlargement process can continue, and that both Albania and North Macedonia will get soon the date for the next step. Thank you.
I think also the summary of your intervention, which was perfectly on time, so 10 minutes about it was really interesting, and I hope that at the end of the other speaker's intervention we can have possibly debate, a small interactive debate with your proposal. And now I give the floor to Miss Laura Mirakian. Please Laura.
Now is better than former ambassador. I thank you very much for Virginia for inviting me, and Natasha, very nice to meet you, and thank you for your explanations, which will be more or less in line of what I'm going to say. But of course, I cannot get rid of my memory. 30 years ago, I was in Belgrade. During the Bosnian War, during the Croatian War, and the Balkan War, and so on and so forth. And then I was dealing in the Ministry of Foreign Affairs when I came back to Rome with the Balkan issue, including bombing Serbia and the Kosovo problem. So let me recall briefly two facts, very important facts, when you speak about former Yugoslavia, because these two facts are having an impact nowadays on the behavior of the internal protagonists, Western Balkan protagonists, but also on the behavior and the orientation of the member states of the European Union. The first, of course, is the Bosnian organization, the Bosnian state. Let's say. Before saying that, generally speaking, the collapse of former Yugoslavia was the first major political change since the end of the Cold War. And it was the first NATO out of area operation. And if you remember, for that period and for that crisis, we invented the wording ethnic cleansing. Mm-hmm. right? I can cleanse him.
Yeah, I can cleanse him. Yeah, yeah.
And also humanitarian catastrophe. So there was other later on humanitarian catastrophe, as we know. But that one was the one where the Europeans felt that it was a real catastrophe. Then the two episodes that I want to recall as the first is Dayton Agreement, because Dayton Agreement for Bosnia was a turning point in the wars that led to the final disruption of Yugoslavia. But of course, this genius diplomat who was Holbrooke succeeded in stopping the war, succeeded in giving a kind of architecture to this country, which is nowadays, we know, is not so viable. And this is part of the problem. This peculiar architecture, as we remember, is, of course, three ethnic groups, three entities, which became two later on, and then one presidency, one state, and the rotating presidency. Okay. I want to recall that for Bosnia, we organized 80,000 soldiers contingent, which means that a major effort from a military point of view. Of these 80,000, 60,000 were from NATO countries. All in all, 32 countries contributed to this operation, which was a NATO operation called IFOR, after Dayton, IFOR implementation. The second episode is even more painful, if possible, which was this Serbia-Kosovo problem, which finally led us to strike on Serbia for 78 days. I was in Belgrade at that time, and I saw people crying. I saw people going to the bridge, to the bridges, and well, it was a real tragedy. In the morning, people waked up and went around in town to see what kind of targets were hit during the night. And then I personally saw the police headquarters, the army headquarters, and the Chinese embassy. There was a mistake there. Right? How was it? In any case, a very painful story, which led Milosevic finally to accept a NATO force, NATO, but not only NATO, because Russia was in. During all the stories, Russia was on board, which is very interesting. It was Chernobyl, it was not Putin, but Russia was involved in all episodes of this 10 years long Yugoslav crisis. Then she was part, Russia was part of the contact group for Bosnia. But coming back to Serbia, Kosovo, finally, Russia was calling on the G8. And the G8 decided, well, a compromised formula, not mentioning Kosovo independence. And it was there that Milosevic accepted the troops on the territory. We also saw the peace keeping force K4, which is still there, 50,000 soldiers, including the Russians. Then a civilian administration, as we know, Lawmaker, and a specialized police, MSU, which was mainly Carabinieri. The fact that the Kosovo independence was not mentioned in resolution 1244, sorry, which followed the G8, implied that today there are five European member countries which do not recognize Kosovo for different reasons. And of course, Russia is not recognizing, and the others. So these two episodes, these two, of course, painful episodes have a consequence in today's situation. Because when you speak about enlargement, we have a kind of problem there, which relates exactly to Bosnia and to Serbia. The European Union and the international community in general were displaying all international tools available at that time. It was incredible. A huge, extraordinary effort to stabilize this region. And this is in contrast very much, in my mind, with what has not been done in the Middle East during the Arab Springs and so on and so forth. Is there a kind of racist element? The Balkans are white, are considered Europeans, mainly Christians. The Middle East are not very white, not very Christian, and so maybe they don't deserve our attention. But I stop there, because if I go on. briefly on the Berlin process, because at a certain stage, how was it that Croatia succeeded in joining the European Union? 2013.
After very, 10 years. After
very
10
late, years. Very late.
Yes, it took us 10 years.
But you were the only one.
No, Slovenia entered before us. Slovenia entered before.
No, Slovenia, d'accordo. Slovenia in Croatia. But all the rest was left outside. But what happened in the meantime? Why? Because there was certainly a problem with the Western Balkans themselves. I mean, maybe only Slovenia and Croatia were able to achieve the acquis communautaire, to achieve the standards and so on and so forth. But also there was, in the meantime, kind of enlargement fatigue. We call that enlargement fatigue.
Yeah.
I mean, I remember that Juncker Commission declared formally that no more enlargement after 2005. Well, there was an enlargement after 2005, but just one.
Yeah.
Enlargement fatigue. And then there was the 2008 financial crisis in Europe, economic crisis, and then this 2000 and the declaration by Juncker, moratorium of 5 years, and then and so on and so forth. And then at the end of the story, COVID. also was complicating the matter. The real fact is that this enlargement process lost momentum. And I don't see, I'm not very optimistic about the next few years. I see that there is a gap between declarations, council after council, everybody's declaring and so on and so forth. But the real fact is that there is a Berlin process going on, which is good, trying to organize a kind of regional gathering, connectivity, electricity, common projects, exchange of political dialogue, exchange of youth, and so on and so forth, helping in a sense to interrelate with this region, but in a sense also replacing what is absolutely blocked. For the two reasons that I said before, I mean standards by the Western countries and fatigue from the member states. Standards, Bosnia and Kosovo, Serbia are still the two main blocks, the two main problems. And I don't see how, although the European Union is dealing, now trying to deal since many years with this mediation between Kosovo and Serbia, we had no success. Security, because all this, I mean, this this kind of no advancement in the process is having an impact on security. All these countries have relations with NATO, of course. But as Natasha was mentioning before, there are several security problems. The first is that traditionally, this is an area where transit or origin of any kind of illegal trafficking. Not only drugs, but you know, worse than that. Second, in the last few years, through these countries, there was an extraordinary flux of migrants crossing and trying to reach the European north, I would say. But of course, this has created a situation of security and also having consequence in the European Union cohesion. So in Europe itself, these migrants, we remember 2015, these migrants were stopped, were welcomed at the beginning, and then during the month, they were stopped, they are still stopped by any kind of blocks at the different borders, through the Balkans up to, I would say, the Slovenian-Italian border. Each country tried to not to be the one, I mean, being obliged to welcome these people. And so I think that there was a kind of regression, general regression, violations of the 49-51 Geneva Conventions, of course, but also violence, which in turn create violence. I mean, it's a vicious circle, apart from, in addition to the humanitarian conditions of these people. This also is a catastrophe, humanitarian catastrophe. But we are not able to, let's say, agree among member countries on reforming this Dublin rule, which is a rule which was You know the story of the Dublin, come si chiama? Il regole di Dublino.
Rules of Dublin.
Eh?
Il regolamento di Dublino, the rules of Dublin.
The rules, the Dublin rules, they were invented at the end of the Second World War from the German people who were, you know, migrating towards Germany, you know. So it's a very old one, and we should try to really to reform. The other element of traditional illegal trafficking, the Balkan routes, the migrants problems, and so on. But there is another problem. Speaking about security, which is quanti minuti ho? Eh? Jihadism, Islamic radicalism. I was in Bosnia when I saw with my eyes, so 30 years ago, no? People, strange people, trying to indoctrinate these Slav people, which were Muslim, but I mean, normal Muslim, but these foreign, which were not foreign fighters yet, but the foreign influence, you know, was already during the war, the Yugoslav wars, and they infiltrated. Sometimes they married beautiful Slav girls and they settled down. And I remember no bread without velo, come si dice velo? Scarf, no? If you put a scarf, you will have a... This was the humanitarian help of these people, I want to mention just this because it's important and nobody knows. Speaking about the Arab crisis, Arab Spring, and the ISIS and so on down there. The two countries that proportionally to their population were sending foreign fighters to Middle East were Bosnia and Kosovo. It's not by chance. Because people, this is not ideology. This is a salary. I mean, people join because they are paid for. I saw many of them, not only from the Balkans, but from Africa, for instance. Syria. But also from the Eastern
Syria
Europe.
Is the same to Libya.
Eh?
The Syrian, Libyan,
they are mercenaries.
Yeah.
And so it was for the Bosnian and Kosovo people leading to join ISIS in the Middle East, mercenaries. So, I mean, this is a serious threat to our security. So there are several elements that I was enlisting because I think that security, their security is our security. So we should stop in speaking and declaring and so on and so forth, and we should find something more, let's say, concretely helping them, which is not only money, but we should create trust, mutual trust. It's difficult. But necessary, absolutely necessary, security problem. Russia and China, yes, Russia and China. Russia is very, very familiar with this area. But in the Russian mind, as I said, they participated during the stabilization process and so on and so forth. Now things have changed. But okay, I will stop here and somebody will ask me about Russia and China.
Russia and China, but please conclude.
What about that? What about
Turkey?
Turkey. Turkey has always been there, up to Belgrade. There was two great empires at that time.
Yeah,
the Austro-Hungarian and the Ottoman one. Sure. Different. Different.
Yes.
I come from the Venetian region, and I had, well, and I remember grandfather, grandmother, they had a very good memory about this empire. Checco Beppe. Checco Beppe. Which was the emperor of the Austro-Hungarian Empire. But the Ottomans, they were a different style in ruling. Huh? The first railways between Vienna and Venice, it was built during the Austrian Empire. But the Ottomans, you know, some, no, this is a beautiful story. I was passing by Montenegro, crossing Montenegro, so on, and the Montenegrin colleague told me, I want to show you something. And then he stopped the car, and we were in a kind of wood, mountains, and we entered the mountains. And down and down and down, and there was a church. And this is the way that the Montenegrin and Slav people who were Christian were obliged, no, underground churches, no? So they're still there, underground churches. So Russia is familiar with this area, and it makes a difference between the former non-aligned area and the eastern, near Eastern Europeans. So I don't think that Russia has a kind of willing to. They are accepting that they are Europe, and they are even accepting that they are NATO, because many of them, they are NATO, including Montenegro and so on and so forth. China is different. China has a different methodology. It's a newcomer. It was never there. But the Silk Road mentality, and so they are trying to advance, you know, slowly, and they are through financing infrastructures, through the bridge.
Hello, everybody. Don't worry, Laura.
In your time.
Don't worry. Dear Ambassador. Okay. I'm very pleased to be here with you and have the opportunity to share some standpoints which I can see from the Observatory of the CI. The CI is, as you know, the Central European Initiative established already in November 1989 with 17 member states currently. It is a governmental organization, but we can say that thanks to the umbrella of the governmental drive, we have a large opportunity to promote regional cooperation from the bottom up in different fields that can range from youth education and orientation to European perspective or science diplomacy, or the mobilization for the SDGs of the United Nations agenda, etc. My point today is this way: the frustration of European supporters in the Western Balkans. I think we need to care a lot of this, and this is a very consistent task for a prominent civil society organization as the European movement is. But why is frustration in the Western Balkans towards the European Union, where EU commitments are growing constantly and in financial terms, as we also saw in the recent appropriations to the IPA 3 and the Economic Investment Plan, where there is a permanent attention from the EU institutions, as last but not least, the visit of the chair of the commission in the Western Balkan capitals assessed before the Brdo summit. And the same Brdo summit, which is quite the third in a yearly row, to take place along with the EU presidencies after Sofia and Zagreb last year. So there is no dismissal of the Western Balkans issue in the EU debate and the institutional life, but what is perceived is a new ambiguity towards the Western Balkans. And this ambiguity is affecting the mood of pro-European European militants that are our sisters and brothers in Western Balkan countries. There are different dimensions of the issues, but how much impacted negatively on the meaning of the mission of von der Leyen, the news spread by Reuters on the questioning and conflicting about the use of the word enlargement absent from the conclusions of the previous summits that was of the same importance in the media along with all the week. And what is the impact of the evidence that there is no new chapters open in the bargaining on accession for Serbia since December 2019 and for Montenegro from since June 2020, or that Kosovo, according with authoritative opinions, ready in technical terms for visa management since 2018, but the issue is frozen. And more, what is the impact of the Bulgarian discussion with North Macedonia that stopped since we are going to 2 years of freezing on the opening of the accession process formally with Albania and North Macedonia. Mm. Or the crazy bureaucratic approach that brought to launch the conference on future of Europe with exclusion of Western Balkan countries that was formally recovered just a few months ago after the Prespa forum that found the key to reconnect the people from the Balkan countries to this European shaping in progress. And also the the delay in the in the sanitary cooperation when the COVID pandemic spread. This is the roots. These are the roots of this ambiguity that determines frustration. Even the pro-European circles are strongly committed to stand and to advocate new, more effective approaches by the European decision-making processes to the expectations of the people, the citizens, and therefore the relationship with the government and the institutions of the Western Balkan countries. The origin of the constraints, in my opinion, remain in the approach, fully justified, of course, of the fundamental first, already in the end of the first decade of the millennium. Because fundamental first actually shifted the approach on a centralized management of EU funding and a progressive reduction of the focus previously addressed to the bottom-up promotion of new skills, reforms, in particular in the fields of entrepreneurial development, investing on the role of SMEs as economic boosters and also civic society feeders, on civil society organization, and in particular on the role of municipalities and regional authorities were existing in order to promote a decentralized reform of the power system. New procedures recently introduced by France's initiative didn't redirect this trend. And we must ask ourselves if there is enough strength in the reform process, if it is or should be led on by government that are frequently, I think to the case of Serbia, currently in particular, undermined by the implementation of the principle that European Union suggests and pretend as conditions for going further in the accession process. So that it is quite strange that there is not enough investment on a reform approach that would be able to promote the function of the civil society, of the local and regional authorities, of the spread entrepreneurship and its associations against with the big economic powers. Not by case, in this uncertain picture, bilateral conflicts are re-emerging. Media freedom is questioned again. Corruption beyond of the institutional commitment and the emerging professionals fighting against is still pervading the society. and brain drain continue weakening the future of the region. Even there are the opportunities to change the path of EU support to the reform process needed to open the doors of membership to Western Balkan countries. I think there is a great importance in matching the shortages I mentioned: entrepreneurial development, civil society organizations support, and making the most of local authorities and regional ones were existing in order to prepare also the decentralization of programming capacity and the preparation for future regional policies that were already starting in the beginning of the millennium, because I worked project where the region, the institution building or regional agencies and the capacity of decentralized bodies were the focus of far looking vision of the Commission in order to reform the shape of the states. To conclude, there are initiatives that ask for answer from Brussels. I think, for instance, to the recent letter sent by prominent Balkan CSOs to the EU institution in order to achieve an inclusion of technically skilled CSOs into the management of Western Balkan investment framework in order to have an internal monitoring and qualification of the allocation of the investments in the main infrastructural projects. The importance of a confirmed commitment of the European Council to the rejuvenation of EUFOR for the security of Bosnia and Herzegovina, where the tensions are still evident. Or, concludo subito, or the continuation of the attention growing in the conference on the future of Europe about the issue of Western Balkans enlargement, that is an important factor also to prevent new step back by some member states of the Union. And the further in facilitation of the regional cooperation sector that is still alive from our initiatives, as I said, but in particular from the Regional Cooperation Council action and coordination of sector regional policies like the regional economic area launched last year. What more could be do? Certainly some news can be in the agenda for the next years. Yes, like a structural funds approach to the economic support that the relaunch also the catching up of the Balkan economies that is the last fundamental factor for membership. Thank you. Thank you,
Mr. Poli, and I'll give the floor to the debate directly, because we listened to very interesting witnesses, data, information, analysis, very deep lessons learned.
So I would like to give the floor to the audience, please, with questions or remarks. I see two at the bottom of the room. Please, can you come here to take the microphone? Professor Pace, they're really quiet. You should come here, otherwise they will not hear you. I'm sorry for that. And then we have, yes,
Vice President of Greece.
President of Malta. I would like to make just a question. These were very interesting discussions again on the Balkans from all speakers. And one thing which I might have missed, because I left it on for 5 minutes to check out my room. Why is there no reference to the public opinion in these countries? And whether this is a cause of delays, or and whether it is an effect of the process going too slow. Can you explain it? Because I come from a country which is which was one of the big bang process. And it was a political decision to take all the countries together. But today we are experiencing problems, not economic problems, certainly, but other problems, which worry me a lot. Being a Europeanist all my life, I worry more about these non-economic problems than the economic issues. And in my feeling is that if the public opinion in the Balkans is reluctant to move forward with the process, it is not uniform in all countries, I understand that, of the Balkans, should we press on? I mean, this is a question I make.
To whom you want to raise?
Any speaker, I mean, any speaker who would want to pitch in on it.
Natasha.
Okay. Thank you. What I can say, I can read even in this statement from Macedonia, is that it was about 98% for years for pro-EU, for becoming a member, now talking about citizens. And with these delays, of course, there is a decline in percentage. They are saying now there is about 68%. I mean, I can this is, I just found this, 68, I said right, yeah. What we witnessed in Croatia was the same. In the beginning, we had high 5% percentage, more than 90. But then, of course, it's dropping. But talking about Western Balkan and Western Balkan countries and what we were talking about now, there are lots of political problems from Bosnia, from Macedonia, let's go back again to Northern Macedonia. They're saying, and they're aware, we changed the name of the country. You said there was a problem for us to enter EU. We changed the name. And it was really big discussion, and they were not very happy to do so. And now there is another issue that they are having
the language.
With the language and with another member, Bulgaria. So Croatia had the problem with Slovenia regarding borders. And we also struggled, and we were left the same. What I read these messages that the president of European Commission gave to each country. And it goes back to the, you should solve in between yourself, Kosovo and Serbia. You should decide what you will do with plates, with what it is a problem. It was even questioned if it will become problem again with arms, and who knows what might happen. But it is down to the countries, actually, to solve the problems between themselves or inside of themselves. I mean, there are for sure problem with freedom of media, with corruption, with rule of law. We know all of this. How do you help? Well, it is governments that are leading, that are deciding how they will behave, and they are actually doing not probably the best and not in the right direction. How much civil society can actually change, and how loud civil society can be? It's down to them, local authorities. Yes, among us, European movements of Croatia, Serbia, Northern Macedonia, Bosnia, yes, we can, Montenegro, we can help each other. We can give experience, share the experience, help each other. But how loud we can be that Europe hears us, I don't know.
Yes, okay. There is one word by the Gigio.
Yeah, thank you very much. I would take the occasion of this intervention of our friend from Malta concerning the public opinion, saying that finally, if you want, that is our role of the European movement. But we are too weak to play this role as the European movement. Because take into example in the account at least four examples. The first one was the Brexit. The Brexit was a referendum in which the British, English, Scottish, Wales, and so on, they prepared themselves to a referendum in which the European Union, on the other side of the channel, ignored the fact that they discussed a problem that was not a British problem, but was a European problem. So they said the Commission, but also the political parties, the trade unions, but that was not our position, saying if we intervene in the campaign, the British will say, oh, the European would interfere in a national problem. It was not a national problem. We see very well also concerning the problems that we have now with the United Kingdom, that is the European problem, not the national problem. Take into account the fact of Poland. I'm sure, and I regret that, for example, during the demonstrations that Donald Tusk organized in Poland a few days ago, I regret that the friends of European movements didn't decide to take the train or the plane or the cars to go in Poland to demonstrate with the Polish, our Polish friends, supporting the idea that they want to remain in Europe and they want to defend the primacy of the European law against the national law. That is the same situation in Hungary, in which we are living alone in April. Hungary will vote for the national parliament. That is not a national problem. That's a European problem, what will happen in Budapest after the elections. So I think that from this point of view, at this occasion that we are together, we have to think more about what we can do as European movement. Because European movement, there is a gap. There is from one side what we say the bubble Brussels, in which we have initiatives at the European level organized by European movement at the European level, but it's not transnational level. It's in the bubble Brussels. And then we have sometimes bilateral meetings, in which in the bilateral meetings, each national council presents its national position. We have to work more, and that is a proposal that we can support and put on the agenda of the European Movement with the money that we have at the international level. We have to use this money to organize, and I speak to you as treasurer.
Yes.
We have to use, that's not a technical problem. We have to use this money to organize more transnational debates. In which we'll speak together, not as Italians or British or Polish and so on, but we'll speak as Europeans. And the same thing concerning the Western Balkans. One of the frustrations that we see in the candidate countries is that the fact that we are leaving these people alone in their countries. That is the one of the reason of the frustration. It doesn't exist a public European Union. It doesn't exist a European media. What exists, and we know very well, is a European fake news instruments. The only European system that exists is the fake news. We have a lot of European fake news. That's European. The only thing that exists is the European fake news that the national media use, but it doesn't exist European media or press and so on. So that is a question that we have to think about it, a question that is related to a conference of the Future of Europe. Because there is no communication, no information. That is the reason, because the conference is the situation as we know for the moment. So I think that the European Movement, with the others, of course, should work more than now to think about these problems. The first problem, we start now with the question of the public opinion in the Western Balkans, that is very important, but the others, the problems of the respect of the rule of law concerning Poland, concerning Hungary, concerning Czech Republic, and so on, and concerning the fact that these national questions are European. For example, I'm sure that now in Germany, when they're working to create a new German government, my opinion is that the trade unions, the political parties, the civil society at European level should take part in the discussion that they are opening in Germany to create a German government. Because when they discuss in Germany about, for example, the fiscal, the stability pact, that is not only a German problem, the approach of the Germans concerning the stability pact. That is also our problem, what the German government will decide concerning the reform of the stability pact. And other questions, migration, and so on. So I think that our weakness is the fact that we are thinking and while we are acting more as nationals that are Europeans. That is the role of the international European movement. If the international European movement would play a real role at the European level, not a summary of national point of view and position. So, take into account and use this occasion that we are together yesterday, today, not only to reach a common conclusion, but to think about these things and to start to act. The first act that we have to do is to intervene strongly with a radical and violent, not from a physical point of view, but political point of view, in the next national election in Hungary. Because if in Hungary the opposition will win, that will be important for Europe. If in Hungary the Partito della Giustizia, that is a very strange thing, and freedom will win, we have problems. The same thing in, I see my friend in Bertoncini. The result of the presidential election in France in April and the result of the legislative election in June in France, it's also our problem, not only it's a French problem. No? So I think that we have to be more European from this point. Excuse me that I intervene with this.
Yes, thank you, Virgilio, for these remarks.
That's why we are here, Virgilio.
I have here in front another question for the panelists.
Yeah. So a very, very brief one. I just want to say that I come from Greece, so I remember when the negotiations started. Started back in 1979. The idea behind was a political one in order to reinforce the Greek democracy in Greece and help the country. Going through this document, there's nothing. There's no engagement. There's no even a word about commands at beginning of negotiations. Nothing. Which means that for sure. The future is very long. That's the one point. The second point is, I was surprised, I remember, with the length of the negotiations, accession negotiations of Croatia. I remember, because I've been two or three times on some meetings, that Croatia was extremely well organized. I mean, the infrastructure, the civil service, very bad. And the detention procedure, which lasted for 10 years. It was crazy. So for real, it's normal that people will lose interest, and we are not in the same period. We are there is a fatigue now, European fatigue, because as well for the simple citizen doesn't bring much. This is the idea. So I think we have to push in order to take a political decision and not to wait to the small details, bureaucratic matters. And of course, I don't see here anything. Related to a separation of the different six negotiations. I mean, you know, for sure, I don't know, some of the six, one or two or three or four countries are much more advanced than Kosovo and Bosnia and Herzegovina. So they have to go on, at least to show and to reaffirm the commitment of the European Union to at least one, two, three countries. And of course, we can solve problems. That was the case in Greece, and I finished with this, with extremely long transitional periods. You are a member, but in order to be an effective member, you'll have to wait for certain years in order to adapt your legislation. So that's another tool which can, by taking a political decision, can solve the problems. Thank you. So I want your opinion on this idea.
Thank you very much also for the question and consideration. I don't know if anyone of the panel want to respond.
Sure.
Miss Laura Wenakian.
Thank you. No, I think that you're right. Berger, it was not helping us because, but this is part of a general trend in Europe, unfortunately. And I tried before to mention a few points. The economic crisis 2008-11. Then the 5 years moratorium. I mean, it was lost. The Western Balkans were lost in the middle of all this. The last one was COVID, of course. So it's true what Virginia is saying, that communication is important. And I would add the people-to-people contacts are important. Universities have a role on that, you know. But also think tanks, you know, and this Future of Europe initiative, it's an opportunity to link, to relink the Balkans, because we are losing links, you know. We are losing the knowledge. We are not familiar to each other, which is historically paradoxical, because, you know, we always have been. You know, when I was thinking, for instance, when was it that Southeast Europe, the denomination Southeast Europe, was replaced back to Western Balkans? When was it? Because in this very moment, we were detaching Western Balkans from Europe. I think it was around 2005, or maybe later on, I don't know. But I was, I was in Brussels, and suddenly I saw in the Balkan, Western Balkan Working Group, somebody said, well, from now on, we call them Southeastern Europeans. And it was, you know, enthusiastic about. Then suddenly, maybe after 10 years, you know, we are back to Western Balkans. And the title of this seminar is again Western Balkans. How was it? So, you know, names are important. The denominations of the words are important. The first is communication. So this is a bad communication. This is not a Western Balkan working group. This is a Southeast European working group. So we started from these very little things, you know, but they are important. And also huge effort that Ursula is doing in Brussels to organize this platform. It's important to include them, and those include them. It was not included, now it's included. Yes. Now it's, so you know, these are signals. We should relink connectivity. It's a matter of people to people first. And then you have railways, energy, and so on and so forth, fishing, and so on and so forth. Thank you.
Thank you, Laura, and I pass you the word to Virgilio.
Yeah, two things. First of all, as I know, the final decision to give the possibility for the citizens of the Western Balkans to use the digital platform, this final decision for the moment is not taken.
It's not taken yet.
So we asked that there should be a movement in Italy at the beginning that we had to open the digital platform. First of all, to the citizens coming from the accession countries. Secondly, we have the 8% of the European population. That means that non-EU citizens, 8%, that they have no access to the digital platform. From my point of view, that is anti-democratic. The fact that 8% of the citizens living in Europe had not the possibility to have the access for the digital platform.
So it's not decided yet?
No, it's not decided. No, the non-European citizens living in Europe have no access to this digital platform. On the contrary, for example, the right of petition is open to the non-EU citizens. The Charter of Fundamental Rights, the majority, is open to non-EU citizens. That is a scandal, that is non-democratic. But the problem is that the institutions together decided that the digital platform has to be open only to the EU citizens. I think that that is a scandal. Second question is the question of accession. You remember very well that the European Commission asked the governments at the beginning of the negotiations with the central and eastern countries to use the method of the race. The method of the race was the fact that they start all together and then they arrive at the end of the race only the countries that were well prepared to become member of the European Union. But because the negotiations are only intergovernmental, as we saw in the summit in Slovenia, that means that each government put on the agenda its own apparently national interest, because the French have the interest to have this country, the other countries. And that was the conclusion that the governments for the negotiation for the accession for the Central Eastern countries decided to use not the method of the race, but the method of the Big Bang. They will enter all together. From my point of view, that was a mistake. That was a mistake because it was true that not all the countries were prepared to become member of the European Union together. And the European Union was not prepared to accept at the same time 10 member countries. So the mistake was not for Prodi, the mistake was for the government. I remember that Delors in the summit in Lisbon said, pay attention, because accepting with the method of the Big Bang, all the 10 countries together will create problems, not only for the countries, but also for the European Union.
Exactly.
So it's the same question for the Western Balkans. If we maintain the idea of the Big Bang, we have to accept the accession of all the Western Balkans together. They never become members of the European Union. That is the risk. So we have to introduce Western Balkans the method of the race. They start together and then they will arrive only the countries that are preparing to enter in Union. I think that we have to remember this idea of the Commission difference between the race and the Big Bang. I think that as European Movement, we have to think about the possibility to elaborate a short paper renouncing the idea of Jacques Delors and the others of the concerning the difference between the Big Bang and the race.
Just shortly, I can't get used to this. I don't think it's now a question, is it race or is it Big Bang? I think at the moment, unfortunately, there is no
enlightenment. Yeah, I know.
I mean, today, I believe we will get a new reply from Commission, and I'm afraid there will be nothing positive, nothing concrete, no enlargement for now.
Yeah.
And I absolutely agree. I think it was a big mistake when this big group of countries became a member of EU, because we are still fighting now. They were not ready.
Mm.
And all that we were listening yesterday and today, rule of law, why and who is not obeying the rule of law, why is the problem, why Europe has a problem. I think they were not ready. But on the other hand, yes, I'm afraid there will be no enlargement.
Yeah.
But sure, we should be loud, sure, we should help each other, introduce or whatever we can think of. But it seems that it's not very popular at the moment.
Okay, in the society, maybe it's popular. So you have a question for Virginia, you said, Laura?
See, because I would like to know, what do you think about the last year decision by the Council? Last year, I think the input was mainly French. But I'm not sure. It was the procedure for dealing with enlargement was changed. Rather than the Commission being in charge, and the Commission only, and then the results are brought to member states, which are approved or not approved, the procedure has been changed. The Commission is not the main protagonist. Six clusters have been organized and been fixed. And then member countries are protagonists in negotiations. It's not only the Commission, it's member countries deciding the rhythm, the path of the negotiation with a single country. But what do you think of that? Because I think that it is detrimental not only for these negotiations, but it is part of a trend, which is the Lisbona trend of having a unanimity. And so it's a way of blocking them.
Yeah, I totally agree. Unfortunately, one of the main reasons of the mistake of the Treaty of Lisbon that was made throughout an agreement between Angela Merkel and Tony Blair.
Sì.
Angela Merkel, Tony Blair called on the telephone Angela Merkel saying you have to put on the other side the constitutional treaty and we have to prepare an intergovernmental treaty. And Angela Merkel accepted the proposal of Tony Blair. So you know very well that the Treaty of Lisbon opened a way of an intergovernmentalism of the European Union, the role of the European Council.
So in this case,
the European Council are violating each day the Article 15 of the Treaty of Lisbon, because the Article 15 said that the European Council has no decisional role. I insist to the European Parliament, the European Parliament should put the European Council in front of the Court of Justice for violation of the Treaty of Lisbon, the Article 15. Uh-huh. And concerning the accession, the Treaty of Lisbon, that was an article of the Treaty of Maastricht and so on, it said that the role of
what the negotiation for the accession is the role of the Commission.
Exactly.
Not only for political reasons, but when we negotiate for the accession, we negotiate on 37 different dossiers. 37,
chapters.
37 chapters. And are very difficult technical chapters. And the only institution that is able to negotiate this technical chapter is the Commission. The Commission knows very well the European policies,
So they are violating Article 15.
I'm sure that they are violating this article that gives the Commission the only role to have the negotiation just in the Treaty of Maastricht. Is the accession. So there are 37, I was in the Commission, so I know more or less the proceedings. There are 37 chapters, technical chapters, they are very difficult. So when we open a negotiation for an accession, the delay is not only a political delay, but is also the fact that we have to negotiate 37 technical chapters that are very difficult. That is the reason because a negotiation will dure normally 7 or 10 years. Because there are a lot of negotiations. So
introducing member states in the decision
making.
It's a way of blocking.
Blocking. So we have to respect the treaty.
And
I think that is also responsibility for the parliament. That is the question, because the parliament is divided. And the parliament, unfortunately, became a kind of intergovernmental body. Because in the parliament, the role is not in the hands of the political groups. But before a meeting of each political group, there is a meeting of the national delegation of each political group, in which the national delegation say that is the position of Italian, French, or German delegation. And then when we have the meeting of the political group, the head of the Italian delegation raised the hand and say that is the position of Italian delegation. And the same thing also for the others. So there is a kind of intergovernmentalism that is expanding in all the European Union. I'm not against the intergovernmentalism for ideological problems, but because the intergovernmentalism blocked the European Union. That is the question.
Exactly.
So I think that the European movement had to be strong for us, first for the European Parliament, because that the European Parliament is weak and weak more in the moment in which the Commission will lose powers.
Exactly.
No? Mm-hmm. When the Commission loses the powers, the European Parliament lose powers. That is the question. Both together. They can be strong together or they can be weak together.
Always together.
So that is the reason because I think that we have to put the Government Council in front of the Court of Justice. Yes. If we can create with the next generation a strong, large prison in Luxembourg, we can put the 27 head of state and government in the same prison in Luxembourg as a violation of Article 15. But unfortunately, this violation is not criminal, it's only institutional. We have to put in the treaty also the criminal act violating the treaty.
We cannot organize it.
No, but we can organize. They put Spinelli in jail for 10 years. We can put the head of state for 6 months in jail. Probably they will understand something. No. That is the reason. When we are together, the 27 around the table, no, you know very well that before the Treaty of Lisbon, the head of state and government were supported in the meetings by the Minister of Foreign Affairs. It was a control from the center. Now they are alone. They are alone. 27 are alone. No people is around the table. And so they think that the power is in the hands of the state, head of state and government. So think about this question. That is the reason we, as European Movement, we are federalists. We say that we have to change European Union and go in the direction of federal Europe. That is the only way to be democratic, efficient, and concrete. That is a kind of a conclusion that I can, but I want to know your opinion. As we said yesterday, we discussed about four things: the conference on the future of Europe. My idea, I don't know if you support, I think that this conference should end not in spring 2022, because there is no enough time, but this conference should end at least in autumn 2002, at least, but not, why not during the Spanish presidency in autumn 2023, eventually. But it is absurd to think that this conference will end in spring. A second point is the decision of the conference should be in the hands of the conference and not in the hands of the three co-chair, because that is not democratic. That concerning the conference. Concerning the own resources, if you want that the European Union will become, have a strategic autonomy, they need a true European budget on own resources. Concerning the Mediterranean, we debated this morning a lot, and there are a lot of things that the Commission proposed in the communication. And concerning the Balkans, we discussed about the fact that the governments in Slovenia supported their apparently national interests that blocked the situation, that more or less. But our friend, Professor Pace, would take the floor, but you can come here. No, Norbert also. So if you come here, both, not to speak together. So we can risparmiare tempo. So you too.
Because we have a tradition of academic modesty.
Yeah.
We don't like to be in the front line, but then I agree with you fully on the first issue of the future of Europe conference.
Yes.
The only thing which perturbs me is that should we give a deadline when it should end? We should say that it should be prolonged as much as is necessary, that we have wasted time due to the stagnation in the period, yeah, due to COVID and so on. So it is, you know, there is no time to complete a meaningful conference within the time limit, being the official time limit as of spring of 2022. So it should be certainly be prolonged, and prolonged as long as it's necessary to complete its work properly. I mean, I'm not sure about this, to be honest. Because even giving a date when it should end, we have no, you know, guarantee that it will complete its work within that period. What should we do? I mean, let's think about it properly. Should we specify a date when it should end? Or should we say that it should be prolonged because of the delays? And assume, yeah, it was a phrase used by one of the speakers, I don't remember when, who. when it has already completed its work. I don't know. I mean, yeah, I'm not.
Luis Norberto. I saw in the newspaper, Luis Norberto, that one person, I don't remember who, said that we have to create the conference as a permanent body. I'm not so sure that is the solution. So we have to, at a certain moment, decide when they stop, but it's impossible to think that they stop in spring 2022. So I hope that our Spanish friends will take the chance.
But we don't need the results.
Well, just two very brief remarks regarding the things we were dealing with yesterday. Well, first of all, thanks a lot. Many thanks to you and to all the colleagues from the European Movement in Italy for being able of bringing together such a wide group of very distinguished speakers. And it has been a pleasure to share with you these 24 hours. Well, the first thing is, yesterday we were dealing with the governance of the conference, and I think it's probably not worth regretting anymore about the governance as such of the conference, but I think we should insist at least on two issues. The first one, I think, it's the feedback mechanism, because at the beginning, a precise feedback mechanism was going to be set up in the rules of procedure, and I think there is nothing concrete about that. And I think it's very important to focus on this feedback mechanism, or the whole feedback process during the conference. And the second one is how to translate all the contents of the conference into a final document. The thing you mentioned yesterday, I'm not sure, well, the consensus about the three pillars of the conference is not, I think we agree, or it's not the best way. I don't know if it should be a majority, but anyway, we must focus as well on this, on the way in which all the content of the conference will be translated into a final document, and that the conference as a whole has a say in this final document. With all the inputs coming from civil society and for citizens. And my second remark, very briefly, is about something that our colleague, the Portuguese judge, Mr. Marques, mentioned yesterday regarding the rule of law. And I think we should be aware that this is not essentially a technical problem. It is a political problem. And we should claim for a common and a stronger common strategy from the three political institutions within the union and from national governments. This is very, I think it's very important. It's not a question of bringing more and more cases before the Court of Justice. We cannot put on the shoulders of judges the responsibility to repair all the damage already caused to the rule of law within the European Union. The Court of Justice must do its work, of course, but it's essentially a political problem, and we do know very well this in Spain regarding other political problems in the last few years. Thank you.
Other intervention from the floor, Tony, Michalis. And I don't know if Eve would take the floor.
Yeah, that's a very small remark. Is for me, it's not very clear how the participation of the civil society, of the citizens, the written contribution will be treated. Because I have heard that nobody will read this in some member states, and they will be thrown to the wastebasket. And this is an exercise, not to justify the democratic process or, you know, the idea. So, and people having this in mind, they don't participate. So I think we have more, somehow have a clarity on this procedure. Thank you.
That is a wonderful question of not transparency of the conference. Eve and Michalis.
Grazie. Thank you very much. So just two quick points on the conference and on our previous discussion on the Northern Europe. On the conference, the future of Europe, let's face it as it is. It was an initiative launched by Emmanuel Macron. You may remember an op-ed to beyond the member states, by the way, beyond the government, to the public at the very beginning of the European election campaigns. So he proposed 2 years at that time. Why did he propose 2 years? Because he wanted it to have it landing during the French presidency. To have it starting during the German presidency and then landing during the French presidency, simply because he believed that only France and Germany are important, in particular France. Now, it was disrupted by the COVID-19, but Frontier, I believe 2 years was a good duration, and that is precisely why it has to last 2 years. And I told him directly some weeks ago in L'Elysée, I said, President, sorry, you can't force things like this, because this would be seen as a tool for you or for France, for your party. So that's why, and why do we have to limit? Because you need to create momentum, so to involve people, because it cannot really be a never-ending process. And I believe then 2000, it's starting. So 2023, yes, 2023. Mm-hmm. It's 1 year before the next European election. The new leaders to be appointed is quite fair and consistent. Finally. Again, I say it's an anecdote, but I'm a member of the plenary of this conference, the Future of Europe. We are supposed to meet in Strasbourg at the end of the week. I still don't know in which working group I'm in. You know, so it's really late, and there are struggles everywhere. So this cannot end now. It's about to start. It's starting. First, second, very briefly on the discussion we have had today. You have mentioned public opinions in thoughts on Europe. You have mentioned the importance of the expression. Yes, you're right. Thoughts on Europe. It's not like Western Balkans. And if I may, it's not an enlargement, because they are in the middle of us. They are surrounded by us. So we should not, because Turkey, Belarus, this is enlarging. This is not an enlargement, it's a consolidation. They're in the middle.
An inclusion.
You may call it, but I think enlargement to the Western Balkans should be totally rephrased. And on public opinion in my country in particular, even in the European movement in France, there are mixed views about this future accession. But it is also because, you know, the French would believe it was better when Europe was smaller.
Yeah.
Because it was a France in bigger, that is the
before
French
the Big Bang.
And so we have to work, of course, not only in direction of public opinion in the Southern Europe countries, but also in some countries like France, because we know that France blocks the Netherlands, Denmark. We are here, and so I think I've talked about France. And for this to happen, we need to try and shape public opinion in France as well, because, you know, Macron. Maybe a European, and then he is a European, but he is very shy. He can't. He doesn't have any political resources to contradict French public opinion, which is not in favor, actually. So what we have to do is common action, common events between maybe from Germany is key, because Germany is more in favor. But maybe, yes, Croatia, Serbia, some movements, you know, kind of showing what it would be. And finally, final word. This can also be made in the framework of the Conference on the Future of Europe, because we can express views, we can organize events. And this is, I mean, it's not the Conference on the Future of the European Union.
No.
It has
Europe.
Been designed
for Europe. Exactly.
Europe.
Yeah.
This has been chosen properly. So I think we should put common positions, maybe events, in the framework of this conference. So that would be very helpful if we can leave one with this in mind.
Michalis, and then Ugo, and then Francisco.
So, we have to be glad, I think, that for the first time, even indirectly, citizens, European citizens, participate in a conference. It's a stake. We have to be sad, because this participation is not guaranteed in any way. If we take into consideration the political time that is needed for politicians or governors or prime ministers or presidents to prioritize their activities, I think that we have to give France the possibility to use the first conclusions, a result of this conference. For me, 6 months postponement means nothing. So maybe we can construct the first results, the first conclusions for the French presidency and for the French elections, and then prolongate our time for the conference proposed, or not now decide, till the end of the period. Which is the end of the period? The end of the period is 6 months before the European elections of May or June 2024. This is an ideal political time. So we compromise politically with a different stage of willingness to promote Europe for our for their own, let's say, priorities. And on the other hand, we do a concrete and profound work. Considering, of course, the Western Balkans case, we have to insist on what was said and prepare a small, but let's say, juicy resolution on what, yes, we really want to. Because this, you know, it's a game of stake with other powers, China, Turkey, states, Russia, intervening in Western Balkans and doing the, not the Macedonia first, but the Macedonia of politics. Thank you.
Ugo and then Francisco.
Well, I heard several very, very, very good proposals concerning the extension on of the conference, and I'm not going to, you know, to have my say on that or specifically on the deadline, but I really want to stress that they're quite interesting, both of them. And what I want to now to put the accent on is about awareness. So we definitely have a problem of awareness. There is very few, very low awareness about the conference, you know, actually happening. And we always have a problem with such process in Europe, similar processes in Europe, because it's a very complex machine, and to make it work, it takes time. It takes even more time to make people aware that this is happening. So in my opinion, obviously, if it switch on at one point, we have certainly all a huge interest in making it going on. Because, well, then every day we have one more media, maybe we have one more you know, side of Europe where the debate becomes wider, and this plays for us in my opinion. I finally want to also to go back to Virgilio's proposal to demonstrate when there are, you know, European or issues of European interest, but you know, that in the first instance, you know, in some countries, in some member states. I have the in my mind now the example of JEF. So the JEF every year makes an event, which is called, which is an event for democracy in Belarus. They make it every day. They have one Belarus day. Yeah, sometimes, you know, it's you know, I think, well, Belarus again. Yeah, what is you know, it's even they even insist sometimes you know, too much, but I think the idea is good because they organize events in all countries simultaneously on the very same day. So it's an awareness raising event, and it happens in all Europe. It is certainly easier to do things in your country then moving to Warsaw or to Budapest. Certainly, when it is the case, then, well, let's do it, let's go. I wouldn't be the one who doesn't take the, my luggage and goals, but we can, or we should try to make in this time of interconnection, we should try to do such events. Like, for instance, the rule of law day in Europe, just Europe-wide, or when you have elections in Hungary or in other occasions, we should really try to do things Europe-wide in all countries and somehow interconnected. That might interest that, well, thanks to internet, that will be, not so difficult to make it known, and that might also raise attention of some people. Thank you.
Hugo, Francisco.
Thank you. First of all, I am completely agree with your final proposal that we need to speak like Europeans. And this is the work that is necessary to make our movement. In relation of the conference, I have three ideas. The first, that the composition is not correct. The general idea was that the institutions and the citizens and civil society, they made proposals in equal conditions. Now it's not true. There are 2/3 of the institutions and 1/3 of the civil society and citizens. Also, I don't like the panels. I think it don't work okay. Is very large to explain, but also I don't like the multilingual platform. Don't work. And I don't like the work. It is not possible that the work were over the plenary. It is completely wrong. As you know, I belong at the plenary, and I don't like how are working till now. And also, there are a problem, not only the composition, there are a problem of the working, of the daily working. We are very delayed. We spend 6 months and we only have 1 plenary. Now we have 6 months more and we have 5 plenary more.
And then it's the end.
Yes, exactly. I agree that it is necessary to be more time. But this is another problem, because I think all of our wants to change the treaty is necessary, the convention, and we need time. And also, I think it's necessary to change the treaty before the elections of the next elections. Another question is, that now there are as consequences, as I say, now in the institutions, there are the idea that it is the convention. And they say me directly in public opinion, what is your legitimacy? I have the legitimacy, you don't have. It's clear that it's not possible to have the same power in the conference. It is completely wrong. It is completely wrong, because they have the possibility in the convention to make its power. Now is an innovation very, very interesting that we are going to work the civil society and the institutions at time, and this is not working. The last example, he says that he don't know in what working group they are. I know, but yesterday I know. But I don't know how they elected the president of this working group. And the 8 working groups are president by the institutions. And only one is president
for women, the young people, that is only for young questions. It is not adequate. It is completely wrong. The composition is wrong, but the working function is completely wrong. And we need to make something. The movement, the European movement, needs to have a declaration now about this. But here we have another problem. Some of the representation of the social civil of the European movement of faith have some ideas. But the problem is that in the European movement, there are a lot, the majority, I think we are 25 of the European movements in the plenary, but more than a half belongs at the institutions. Mm-hmm. And this is very contradictory. And I belong at the national events. There are now some agree about it is not good functioning. And they represent the civil society, the majority. And a half is very, very, very young, are very young. I'm very clever. And now we need to join to have the representation of the civil society join. And I have an idea. I have here the events that we prepare in Spain, in Spain. We made 17 and we need to do 30 or 40 more. I would like that some of them were made with other movements. We are prepared to invite a lot of people came from other movements, and it's necessary to join. This is my proposal. Thank you.
Can you hear that of your it's possible to have this?
I have one for
we are for, ready to for, come
for movement.
Yeah. So I don't know. It's 1 hour and 30 minutes. So I don't know if there are other interventions. We started this morning at 9:30. Now it's 1:30. It's more or less 4 hours. I think that for the people is. Perhaps tired that they want to profit of the beauties of Rome. And so I can you give you the freedom. The freedom is important. Spinelli decided to put outside the Communist Party because he thought that the freedom was more important than the ideology. So, because that it is the 80th anniversary of the Manifesto di Ventotene. I would thank all the people that is born here. I calculated that 60 people from yesterday to today I were present online, 60 people, and more than half of these 60 people, 32, had the possibility to take the floor. That is good. I think that we had the possibility to have a good exchange of views. I accept and welcome the proposal, informal proposal of our friends from Spain, that next Med 8 will take place in Madrid. Mm-hmm. I hope that we have the possibility in the next months to create a European movement in Slovenia, mm-hmm. to have a Med 9, mm-hmm. because the government now, they organize the Med 9. I think that it will be useful to organize this meeting before the first end of the conference, so it's possible between January and March maximum, if you had the possibility to organize it. So We are waiting eventually your proposal, and or in Madrid or in other part of Spain. It's your choice to decide the region in which we meet. And so, thank you very much. It was a great pleasure for me. And the possibility to meet another time friends that for different reasons it was not possible to meet in the last time. And for me personally, it was also a good chance to be with you. That means that we are able another time to work together. That's important. We will not only live, but we have the energy to go to work together.
I will take the floor in front of all of you, and I believe we have the same. Thank you for Virgilio to put us all together and to spend, as you said, more than 24 hours together. And let's meet in Spain next time.
Yeah.
Thank you.